We've just got a couple little motions.
Oh, yeah, first. You do what you need.
You smile. See? And Mr. Henderson, sir, I brought my fruit.
We're live. We're live. We're ready.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This work session of the Hampton Municipal Budget Committee will come to order at 7 p.m. on Tuesday, the 15th of November. Please rise to the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. If the members of the Budget Committee will introduce themselves, starting with Mrs. Bridle on the viewer's right.
Ginny Bridle, School Board Representative.
Regina Barnes, Board of Selectmen Representative.
Mike Pierce.
Sonny Kravitz.
Brian Lopham.
Steve Henderson.
Mike Plough.
Stephen LeBranch.
Jones.
Danielle Augustine.
David Mora.
Chuck Rage, Hampton Beach Village District Representative.
And Barbara Kravitz is our secretary. This evening, before we start fire, we just want to, I'll accept a motion. Mr. Pierce, are you prepared?
Yes, I'm prepared.
Yeah. Invite the finance director to our December 1st meeting.
I'm prepared to do this.
Yes.
Okay. Yes, if everybody can see the flyer that I passed out, if everybody has a slide, it starts off with a small paragraph on the front page and a bunch of numbers on the second and third page. What this is an Excel spreadsheet. You look at the second page, it starts off with 83,629, I believe. And you'll notice that there are in ascending orders numerically, starting at the top and going all the way down to the bottom. And what this is a listing of the accounts in the budget book that have increased and by how much they've increased. And it starts off with the highest dollar amount at the top of the page. And on the end of the second page, which is a very small dollar amount, because I didn't give you the accounts that are going to the negative, but there's a whole spreadsheet if you want the whole thing. But the point being that all of the increases we're seeing in the budget this year are pretty well spread out, and almost all those you see with the lines around the dashes, those all are related to salaries for employees, like insurance, etc. So it's employee cost. So that's what the sheet is. And in reference to Louise's request that I ask the finance officer to come in on our December 1st meeting, I make a motion that we invite her to come in so we can talk about the default budget.
Correct. If we have a second to Mr. Pierce's motion.
I'll second, but I want to comment on what he just said.
Okay. Seconded by Mr. Jones.
The summary sheet that you...
Michael, I don't have one.
I'll give you one.
The summary
sheet... One right there someplace.
The summary sheet you supplied with the printout highlights what we were looking for, basically, at our last meeting in terms of where the increases are coming from.
Mm-hmm.
154 line items increased, totaling $1.1 million, the medium increase of 7.4%. 75 of the 154 line items are wage and benefit-related increases, totaling $697,000, with a median increase of 4.3%. Of that $697,000 in wage and benefit increases, only $505,000 are actually included in the default budget, so there's no choice for the voter. You're going to get $505,000 of that $697,000, regardless of how the voter votes. As it stands at the moment.
Now, you prepare for motion because we don't want to take up the fire chief's time. This is something we're going to go through in detail December 1st.
I just wanted to highlight the summaries of the analysis that was done to date with regard to, you know, where we saved over $500,000 in debt service being eliminated, plus to another $295,000 on the bottom line budget for a total of something over $800,000, just where that $800,000 went. The summary sheet and the spreadsheet behind it gives you a better view as to where that money can be found.
Okay. Very good. Mr. LeBranch?
I need some clarification from you.
This is only my fourth year doing this, but my understanding is that this budget committee's mandate is to create a budget for the town of Hampton, the school board, the village district. And my understanding as well is that this budget committee does not have any authority regarding the fall budget. Am I correct?
That's correct.
Then why are we questioning the default budget when we don't affect it in any way? I just don't understand.
Well, the reason I would suggest is that the budget warrant article has two budget figures in it. One of them is the budget that we present as it passes through the deliberative session, and the other one is the default budget. Correct. So the budget we produce inevitably is going to be compared to the default budget. Mm-hmm. Thus, the default budget, for comparative purposes, is always worthy of consideration.
Right. And we have the right to have that information so we understand
what we're doing. We have the information, but we can't change it. That's
correct. We're not saying we're changing it.
Okay,
we
I'm correct in saying that.
We cannot change the default budget. That's correct.
The
proposed budget is ours.
Just needed a clarification.
Steve,
thank
the reason
you very much.
Why we're concerned about it is because there are some items as we've been going along that are being put in the default budget and according to the statute, they shouldn't be there,
David?
In my opinion.
Okay.
Thank you.
Regina?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. As far as the way we prepare the default budget...
Oh, you didn't prepare...
The finance department and the assistant town manager are here, right. And I'd like to have them maybe comment on why we did the default budget the way we did.
No, we just want to go over it in detail because there was a question of retiring nearly $500,000 of debt and how that impacted potentially the 2017 budget. So we want to take the time, but we are not going to impinge on the fire chief's time right now.
So we'll do it on December 1st.
We'll discuss that on the 1st. In favor of Mr. Pierce's motion,
okay.
We'll just review it.
Mm-hmm.
All right. What are you doing, Brian?
I'll abstain.
Brian's abstaining. Everyone else is in favor. Gentlemen, good evening.
Good evening, ma'am.
Chief Ayotte and Deputy Kennedy. Gentlemen, first, I think what we'll do for everybody's convenience is just look at the rolling stock first, okay?
Okay.
And we see your beautiful new 2016 Pierce.
Yes, ma'am.
And it says excellent condition. That makes everybody happy. Let's see what we've got here.
Ma'am, since you're on that, could I start with a public service announcement real quick?
Oh, please.
This actually is in reference to rolling stock and also, more importantly, firefighter safety. This afternoon, we had a situation. Engine 4 was out on 95, and typically when we're out there, the engine is blocking whatever scene might be there. And one of our firefighters actually was almost hit by a tractor trailer that failed to yield. As you might imagine, I know that in this state we have a move-over law, so anybody who's working on the side of the highway, their safety is guaranteed if you aren't in their lane, or at least to some degree. This afternoon, it was exceptionally close and very dangerous. So as far as rolling stop, that could have been an issue there. More importantly, my firefighter safety was potentially hampered by a it was a tractor trailer unit that failed to move over, and hit the cones. That's what made them alert. So I'd like
they
to remind all
the
of
bad
you.
Guy?
They talked to him. But I would like to remind all the viewers that there is a move-over law, and if you see whether it's tow professionals, construction,
excellent.
Police, or fire, please move over.
Excellent.
Thank you, ma'am.
Your rolling stock list is pretty clean. The two SMEALs, the 2001 and 2002, are not looking too cheerful. You're targeting them or one of them next?
We are. Absolutely, yeah. And we're still assessing the situation on engine 2.
And your engine 4 and two of the three ambulances are in excellent condition. Do you have a projection for the ambulance 3?
Well, ambulance 3 is 7 years old. We aim to replace them at 6. As you know, we just purchased a 2016 Ford F-450 for Ambulance 1. That ambulance, I believe, when it left us, was also 9 years old,
right.
Was it not?
Yeah.
So we're a little bit behind the time as far as that goes. We're working to maintain and grow the ambulance account. As it stands right now, we're researching the possibility of looking for new ambulance billing services. But once that account reaches a happy level again, we'll entertain the idea of purchasing another ambulance.
Excellent, because we did get out of sync. There.
A little bit, yes.
Then you've got good, excellent. Now we're down to the utility vehicles. 2005 Ford F-250, the 2000 International Bucket, and the 2011 Crown Vic.
Yes, ma'am. That's actually a cruiser that came over from the police department.
Oh, I wondered about that.
Yeah. We lettered it up, and it's in good operating condition right now. Our firefighters take that to the fire academy if they're going to clean.
Oh, okay.
As far as the bucket truck goes, we've just had some minor repairs done to that for high idle. It's in very good condition. It's still operating, and we're using it. Actually, you may have seen us out in the street the other day. We were replacing some of the light bulbs over at Stickney Terrace on the street signals. As far as the 2005 utility truck, that is definitely showing signs of wear. The frame is a problem, and so is the moreover the body. And the deputy is certainly, he's nodding over here because he knows that he's been telling me about that one for the last 2 weeks.
Uh-huh. And the ATV is not looking too happy.
The older one, the red one, four-wheeler, is certainly older.
Right.
The newer one, I believe, is 2013?
14.
14. 6 years.
And the Marine 2 motor, you already have accommodated.
I believe it was removed from this one. We're going to entertain the idea of moving it to next year. As it stands right now, that boat is harbored inside of our Brown Ave Fire Station, the Beach Fire Station.
Okay.
It's taken out for when we need it in Hampton Harbor. Marine 1 is still in the water. Last year, we replaced an engine. So.
Because other than that, you know, good job and good condition on the vehicles in the department. Anyone have questions on the vehicles? Sonny?
One question I have is, you know, you've got a bunch of towns in the area. Is there any coordination in purchasing equipment between the towns? Because, you know, small towns can't afford it. And you call on each town if there's an emergency.
For municipal aid, we certainly do. For mutual aid, I apologize. Yeah. We certainly do. However, this town, this community is one of the larger ones in the area. And our frontline apparatus, whether it's engine 1 or engine 4, reserve apparatus engine 2 and 3, and ladder 1, they're responsible primarily for our jurisdiction, which is our town. We do go mutual aid to other towns, and we supply them with assistance. But as far as coordination with purchasing, there's really no mechanism to do that as far as pricing goes. They're on a different time frame than we are. Ours operate, we drive up engine hours and mileage faster than Hampton Falls, faster than Northampton does.
Yeah.
So it would be a hard thing to coordinate with a consortium or anything like that.
Yeah, because I see Exit has built some high-rise condos.
They have.
Did they purchase equipment to fight a fire there?
They will. Yeah, absolutely. They were actually, if I'm not mistaken,
they have a new ladder.
They just have a new ladder. So
you know what I'm trying to get.
I totally understand what you're saying.
Okay, getting into the main body of the budget now. Starting administration, regular wages.
I'll move to final dues.
Well, what amount? Are you moving? The 225-203?
Sounds good to me.
Okay. Seconded by Mr. Henderson. Okay. The fire chief is the only member of the Hampton Fire Department who does not belong to the union, because it was a very canny deputy chief a number of years ago who insisted on joining the union. The pay raises that were passed out July 11th and effective April 1st included a 2% raise for non-union chief of department. That was $1,427 in this calendar year, and the total was $1,903 for the year, April 1st to March 31st next year. Deputy and secretary are all both union, and you see their salaries there. Does anyone have a question on that section of the budget? Regular wages, chief, deputy, and secretary.
Madam Chair, what you're saying is you're talking about a 2% increase in 2017's budget.
Well, the 2% increase carries over for the final 3 months into the 2017 budget.
Okay, so there's no targeted raise in the fire department for non-union?
Correct.
In the 2017 budget?
I think not.
Is that accurate, chief?
I received a raise in July, but I do not believe there's one slated for next year.
Jamie, 2017 increases for non-union are not yet projected?
They are in the merit line item.
Right, but not targeted for the
budget. Not in this line, not in this budget.
But they have not been assigned.
Right.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Good question. Everybody comfortable with the 225-203? In favor? Unanimous. You remember, Chuck. You know how it works. Okay. Overtime is zero. Holiday pay. 2 weeks pay per CBA. I'm sorry.
Mary Louise, the second on that motion, Mr. Jones.
Mr. Henderson.
Thank you.
Thank you. That's good, Barbara. Thank you for keeping us on our toes. Holiday.
That was regular wage.
Yes, regular wage is $225,203. Now I'm on holiday pay, $88,449. 2 weeks.
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Jones, seconded by Mr. Henderson. You understand the intent? Ginny, have a question?
Yes, I do. Why are we going line by line? You just want to go line by line?
Well, I'm going segment by segment, my dear. If we go quickly and nobody has questions, we'll hop right to the next segment.
Okay.
I just want to make sure we understand each of the parts. And the budget is pretty well drafted here, so it's pretty clear. So, in favor of the motion for holiday pay, $88,449. Unanimous, I think. Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Okay.
You skipped over overtime wages, by the way.
I skipped over what? No, overtime is zero.
She said zero, Deb.
Career incentives.
She said it. The chairman said it.
He didn't make a motion on his own.
You don't need to make a motion. It's zero. Career incentives, $600. Longevity pay for the secretary, according to the collective bargaining agreement. Motion in favor of the $600.
Could I make a motion?
Quick question. What is longevity pay?
She's been there a long time.
I know, I understand that. But, I mean, just because someone's been there...
That's a benefit that was negotiated with the union, so she's the only member of the department at this time that receives that. After a certain amount of years, there's a benefit that's paid out. After 5 years, 7, I believe 15 is the next step after that, not long after that, right?
Yeah.
Where if you achieve that length of time in your career path, they award you a one-time stipend.
Awesome. Thank you.
Yes, that's all. It was good traction.
And it's kind of a reward for being brave enough to work for the town of Hampton a long time.
Can I make a motion, Madam Chair?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'd like to make a motion to for career incentives.
$600.
Tuition reimbursement for $2,500.
Oh,
staff
okay.
Development for $885. Rentals and leases for zero. Uniforms for $33,840. Supplies and expenses for $4,583, because none of those have an increase. A zero increase. Perhaps we could just make one motion for those, several of them. You can still discuss it.
Okay, just,
no.
Stephen, go.
Anybody want to second that?
Second.
Wait a second, because I want to understand what you did, because you went back.
I'm just taking career.
You did everything except new equipment.
You did career incentives, tuition reimbursement at the reduced amount, $2,500.
Yep.
Staff development. At
$885.
Rentals and leases are zero.
Zero.
Uniforms, $33,840. And supplies and expenses, $7,155.
Correct.
All right. You understand the intent. Seconded by Mr. Henderson. Questions? I have an observation. Anybody have questions? I just want to point out one thing to you. At the bottom of page 31, where it says uniforms, covers the cost of cleaning uniforms, purchase of new uniforms, etc. This does not include turnout gear.
Correct.
This is regular
uniforms,
regular garments.
Right.
This does not include the turnout gear to protect the men. In favor of the motion. Unanimous. All right. Now, gasoline. And thank you, Chief, because you guys broke out gasoline and diesel and all on the specific lines. I have a question for Christy. You said average use, et cetera, $1.95 a gallon. Does that include or not include the state and federal taxes that we do not pay? Where does the $1.95 come from? It's consistent throughout the budget. I just want to know where you got it.
$1.95 was an amount that we came up with by looking at average cost per gallon. It does not include the taxes, so you are correct.
Average cost per gallon?
Yep.
Well, how much is the state and federal tax? About 42 cents per gallon?
Between 42 and 44.
42 and 44 per gallon. So I can get gas at the mobile station up here for $2.09 a gallon.
So to explain where the model came from is that they've been tracking gallons and the fluctuating price, taking an average. And then through our discussions, we came up with because we don't know exactly where it's going to be, a small amount on top of that for a fluctuation for the next year. Now, we have to watch as the year has gone on, that number's changed, so we can dial it in tight. Okay. And that's one of the questions, clearly, that the committee had. And
okay.
That's the methodology we've arrived at, all of these gas prices.
And I do like the way the chiefs broke out gasoline and diesel, so you just don't have a lump there.
Madam Chairman.
Okay.
Before we move off the gas, I have a couple of questions.
So do I.
You want gas? Okay.
We're purchasing gas through the Wix card.
Wex.
What is the spelling on that?
W-E-X.
W-E-X.
Correct. Okay.
Now, Wix has a processing fee, I assume?
No.
They work for free?
Well, no, I mean, it's certainly they get the credit card stuff, and, what we pay from them, I got to break down the bill. Let me say I have to break down the bill. Okay. There's nothing major in our sign-up sheets, none of that stuff. They get a processing fee, I think, on the other side.
Oh, it's on the...
I think so.
Seller side.
Okay. What we pay, and it's a flexibility... We found the prices from the state weren't fluctuating. They're up very high.
Yeah, we found that a couple years ago, too.
That.
Yeah.
Actually, it was this committee last year that forced us to start looking harder at that.
Yeah.
We went to the Wex. Wex gives flexibility to go to pretty much any gas station, and you just buy it at the pump, use the card, and they do the reimbursement. The law changed about a year ago. Okay. We used to have to do that paperwork ourselves. The law changed that allowed the vendor to do it for us, and that's a tremendous savings in administrative time for us. So they do all that work. We just pay the price that they show us at the pump, which is a tremendous savings.
Now, the gallon calculation, is that based on actual experience prior 12 months?
We have a two-year data set at this point.
Okay.
This is based on 16, but we're getting more and more accurate data as we collect from their data set when we have it. Larger the pool, the more accurate it will be. But right now, that's what it is.
Okay.
So it's for the prior 12 months average, right?
The average in the budget is for 2016.
Okay.
Backed it out.
$1.95 for the gallon.
For the gallon.
But if you have 2 years of data set, why aren't you using a one-year data set to estimate the gallons?
We're using 2016 and projecting it out.
We'll go back and look at that. Based on the questions that are coming, we'll go back and look at that again. But the methodology we're using is taking those gallons, which we're feeling more and more comfortable about because they're staying consistent, and then applying. The question's really going to be, where are all of us comfortable with what the average number is and what fluctuation do we anticipate in the next calendar year?
Okay, now on the price, do you buy regular gas or you buy high octane?
Some vehicles require, like the police motorcycles and others, require the high octane, but most everything is the lowest price you can get.
Regular gas. So, if you had 40 cents to $1.95, I don't remember paying $2.35 for a couple of years.
Diesel.
No, regular gas.
We're talking gas. And again, we're going to dial that in a little closer at it, no question about it.
Yeah, so I think we need to tighten that up.
And the question comes, and I think we were using it, and again, I don't know if it was directly in front of me, but it was like 80-something was our number, and we added like roughly 10 cents, because we just don't know what it's going to do in the next year. That's our concern.
Oh, well, I do. It's going down even further.
Mike Pierce, you had a question.
Yes, this is for Christy. You passed out this gasoline chart, and it's a year old. It's out of date, in other words.
I don't believe I passed out a gasoline chart this year. Well, that was not that I was asked to provide.
Where'd you get this in?
I met probably duplicated that from the sheet I had. I did have
last year. I did do one. So if you have one that's a year old, it's probably from last year.
Yeah.
I was not asked to provide the committee with sheet this year.
Well, in view of the fact that we have quite a few questions about the gasoline usage, the biggest offender was the cemetery. We're using a year-to-date of $1,000 to want to really jack it way up. I think we need a document like this so we can look at these gasoline charges pretty closely, because even if you're looking to gasoline on this and you look the actual numbers, if you prorate it, I haven't thought about this particular line item, but what we've seen so far, they're not prorated very well, in my opinion. So a sheet like this would be very helpful.
We can get that information for our final review, which will start on December 1st. Because we know we need to do that. We need to look at cemetery again for their oil and filters and diesel. Okay, excellent.
So we're going to have a new one of these, is that what we're requesting, Madam Chairman?
Beg pardon?
You're going to get a new sheet like this?
Well, the finance director has heard you make the request on behalf of the committee.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. So on the gasoline, what did I have a motion on gasoline?
Yeah, it was part of Steve's motion, I believe, wasn't it?
No,
I didn't. I saw
Mr. Jones is moving for gasoline for the fire department account 42201.
Second.
4,583. Second, Regina, thank
final
you.
Final review.
In favor? And this is temporary until we get the final
figures.
Until
final review. Yeah.
Okay. What are you doing, Ginny?
I voted yes.
Oh, all right. But you voted fast. Okay. Unanimous.
Yes.
She's trying to move us along, you know?
New equipment, office copier, $7,500. And you have the chief's note. Motion on the copier.
I'll make a motion for that.
Mr. LaGrange, seconded by Steve.
Are you doing new equipment?
You understand? That is new equipment.
$7,500.
The office copier.
Yeah.
The chief has a specific note there.
I do, and actually, just so that you know, this note is dated. We've actually had to destroy that copier and throw it out. We're currently using the fire prevention copier, which is older than this one that we had to remove from service. So as far as technology goes, no computers are able to talk to it or print off of it. The one that we're currently using is actually older than the one that we were looking to replace.
Okay. Well, some are good and some aren't. In
but
favor,
the number is not changing.
No.
In favor of the motion
500,
on the copier.
I think we
in
already,
favor?
We already voted.
No, you didn't vote.
Okay, well, we did again.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, we're unanimous anyway.
Oh, I had. All right, we're unanimous. Excellent. Now, regular wages, fire suppression. I want you to note here, please, $2,041,860. If you look at the lineup, you have nine relatively new firefighters in this department. This department had been consistent for a long time. You had the same tough guys who were trained and knew what they were doing and worked hard. And now it's switching over because people are getting injured and they're also retiring. So do you have anyone out on injury leave now? But
I
know
I do have one firefighter who is out on injury leave. He's had surgery at the end of July, and he's slated to return beginning of the year. We also have one vacancy, and
yes,
we're looking to fill.
And so that puts you down to 27 firefighters right away, and then 26 with the vacancy, which is very difficult for a department that does the work that they do.
Madam Chair, I'd like to move the two.
You're going to move the
2,041,860 million.
Okay. Seconded by Mr. Henderson.
The final review on the regular wages of fire suppression.
And I have a couple more comments here. I was watching your appearance before the Board of Selectmen, and you were mentioning something to the effect that you had to wait on some of the water rescue training because you wanted to get the new people on your staff fully invested at least a year before you start doing other types of training.
As you might imagine, you know, coming into a new fire department, whether you've been a firefighter elsewhere or you're coming in green just after training, it takes a little while to get to know the ropes, to understand how we do things at Hampton Fire and how it's different from the department you might have left, or just to go to the recruit academy and come out from there and learn how to do it in an actual operating fire department. That training is ongoing daily with all of our probationary firefighters. The firefighters on duty, the officers on duty, they take it, that's their baby. They take the new firefighters, train them to be seasoned firefighters, really. The best thing that an old firefighter can train a new firefighter to be is an old firefighter, right? So we like to see that. When they do the training like that, they're concentrating primarily on fire and emergency medical services, because that's our bailiwick, and that's where we work most often. Water rescue is a big portion of our business, especially,
yes,
you know, summertime. We've had over 18 open water rescues in the last 3 years. And to that, we put assets in the water. We put people in the water in swimmer gear, and we've rescued people off of the jetty, off of the rocks just outside of Seabrook. We've done it in open water through the surf. So that training, that level of training, is extremely important. But the primary factor for me is to make sure that as a fire department, we're training firefighters first, EMS personnel, because that's a large portion of our volume of calls, and then we're going to get to water rescue.
It's a tough job, and it takes a lot of training. I will mention one personal thing. I helped out at Marston in September when they were having their open house for the parents and new students and so forth. And a gentleman came up to me whom I hadn't seen for many years, Captain Richardson, and God love him. And he said, I went to the fire department and nobody knew me. And I felt so bad. So although I think his picture is up on the wall, but brought back fond memories, and I have such respect for him and the firefighters who have left the department. But this department leaves its mark on everyone. And the chief and deputy have a challenge ahead. It's always a challenge bringing on the new people, especially so many at once. If you have
high quality people, though, ma'am, I'm telling you right now, they're high quality.
Well, we attract good. Any questions? Are you prepared to vote on the amount?
Can you second for this?
Mr. Henderson. On $2,041,860 on page 32. In favor?
Unanimous.
Unanimous.
Madam Chair, I'd like to move the entirety, the subtotal of fire suppression for $2 million.
Well, you've got the overtime, so
we can.
I want to do the whole subline item.
Make your subline motion.
$2,559,127.
I'll second that.
To final review.
Wait a minute. What page are you on?
Same page. On the bottom. Subtotal of fire suppression.
He's on this page.
He's just moving the whole section.
Right.
I know. I just want to make sure that I'm going where I'm supposed to go. Okay, so you're looking at the 24422202.
Correct.
2202.
In its entirety, yes.
I'm trying to find the. There you go.
You had 2,559,127.
Yes, correct.
Okay, you're on page 35. Okay, excellent. And second?
I seconded it.
And Mr. LaBranche seconded. Who made the original motion?
I did.
Mr. Jones.
Okay. I have a few comments in this. Brian, you have a question or comment? Go ahead.
Oh, okay. I was going to get them in first. New equipment. One thing I know is...
Which page are you on, Brian?
I'm on 34.
Oh, there it is. 34 in the middle of the page.
But if you go back through...
The recap?
Through everything in the budget.
Yeah.
Almost every line... under new equipment is zero. That concerns me that...
So we're under fire suppression here, and the equipment that I was asking for is in suppression. The hydraulic tools are on an engine. The ice rescue sled is for firefighters who are going out into harm's way if they're going out on ice to do a rescue. Mm-hmm. So that's why we kept the new equipment there. We're not looking for new equipment other than the copying machine that we just spoke about in administration. We're not seeking new equipment in that area of the budget. So that's why it's placed in that line item.
Okay, that explains a little, but I just noticed it throughout the fire budget that anything new equipment was like zero, and I'm like, are we planning to come down hard on us 1 year or
nope? We are trying to spread it out. You know, we are budgeted for new equipment as a normal budgeting cycle. Mm-hmm. As an example, we had a fire at the Purple Urchin on October 12th. During that time, we deployed two roof saws. Two chains on the chainsaws got destroyed. We had to buy them new. They're $350 a piece. It's not a homeowner's type saw. So in getting that $700 worth of chains, that new equipment is actually already budgeted for in the tools line item. So the new equipment that we're talking about in this particular line item is actual new equipment that we don't have right now and that we're looking to establish on the apparatus.
Yeah.
It just seems like we're... Okay, I guess that answers my question.
Okay, Michael?
Yes, I have a question about the overtime wages, $1,400.
What page are you on?
I'm on the budget page,
What? I'm not
in the detail.
You're in the narrative, guys.
What's the account number, Mike?
I read it up. You're in 202, right? And I said 7450. No, not 7450. I'm sorry. It's 1400.
That's 206, though, isn't it?
There are no page numbers on this page.
Now, Michael, go in the narrative. You've got page numbers, and you've got a complete description. The chief went to the trouble of writing all this stuff.
It's page 22. The war.
No.
Full time.
Where is it?
That's 1400.
What's the amount you're talking about, Mike?
I think it's the 174,000.
Yeah.
Yeah, the overtime line, right on the main sheet here, the general, whatever you call this thing, that's on the operating budget summary by expense page.
And the detail is on page 32.
Yeah.
The overtime. Right.
Yeah, that isn't quite as obvious as it is on the other page, though. Because your actual for what this year is 162,606. And you requested 148, and it was increased to 147 by the admin. 174, right, by the admin. And now we're ending up with 174. So I'm trying to figure out why there is so much overtime, number one, and why are we jumping up with such a big number over the actuals?
We've had, as you can see in the 2015 actual, mm-hmm. right? We spent $325,000 in overtime.
I see that.
In the preceding or the succeeding budget, the next budget after that, we were instructed to come in with a zero-based line item and then default. The $113,000 is a default line item that's come three budget cycles, I do believe. What we projected out was $162,000. Right. Christy was essential in helping us out with this, and we went back 5 years to do an average cost analysis and budgeted per firefighter and per hourly wage, and the actual moving item from a five-year average was $174,000 to project it out. We had a lot of injuries, if you recall, and I know that Madam Wolsey, you just spoke about that.
Oh, yeah.
We did have a lot of injuries, and some of these were job-related, and some of them required people to separate service or retire out because of them.
Right.
While they're vacant, we were filling their shifts. We currently run down to 8, so we're staffed at 9 to begin with on paper, but if somebody's out sick or if there's a vacation day, then we'll operate with 8 firefighters and officers. So what that does is it lowers our operating costs because we're not paying overtime for the 9th person, but even still, with the amount of injury that we saw in the past 2 years, we saw an increase in overtime.
Okay, that helps a little bit. Thank you. Can I answer that question?
Tim?
When you submitted your request, Mr. Department Head, what formula did you use to come up with your differing number?
We were using a similar formula. We were doing based over 5 years. I think it was the last 3 that Christy had helped us out with because the numbers had changed and increased. Sorry?
Your injury rates went up substantially in the shorter term.
In the last 2 years, we saw enough. We saw 5 people out, I think, in 2014 and 6 in 6 for a little while, and then 5 again.
I'm asking about the formula that you used when you presented your number to the town manager.
It was the same formula. She had better figures.
I'm seeing an increase from what you requested, which was 148,000, and that was increased to 174,000. So someone was using different formulas.
And that would be the math problem blamed on me.
So you're using a different formula or the wrong calculator?
Come over and see. What we were doing was calculating out the average for leave, right? We're basing it on sick, vacation, injury, and then the other incorporated timeout would be military and pro time. So the numbers that I was using, that was my mistake. It was inaccurate by several. I believe we had 2 people out that I didn't account for. Christy was able to see that.
So 2 people out resulted in a change in the calculation.
Oh, yeah.
Of overtime,
yep.
Of $26,000.
Yep.
But over the course of a year.
Yep.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Okay, I have a quick question, Christy. The on page 35 of the narratives, The $2,598,152, which was moved, does that include the administration's increase to $174,000 in the overtime wages on 32?
The $2,559,127 is included. It's what is in front of you from admin and BOS.
The same amount. So instead of the $148,914 on page 32, mm-hmm. and you have the total of $2,598,152. It includes the $174,000 rather than that $148,000.
Madam Chair, point of order.
Yes.
Okay. First of all, you're looking at page 35.
Yes.
You have to understand, if you look at the graphic that's on the first page, that includes the changes that the Board of Selectmen made.
Right.
The stuff that's on the other page is a narrative from
like
the chief.
The narrative.
So the motion that I made included the $174,000.
It did, yes.
You made the motion for the right amount. The amount that she's looking at is from the fire chief, but
I
not
just want to make
updated.
Sure we're not
That's why
messing.
You're getting confused, okay?
I want to make sure we're not messing anything up.
It looks like the committee's ready to vote, Madam Chair.
Okay. No, we're not ready to vote yet because I have a couple of comments.
And I have a couple more when you're ready.
So we are looking at page 35.
And I miscalculated, Chief.
$2,598,152. Okay.
You calculated?
Next question that I have is starting on page 33.
Yes, ma'am.
It says, under career incentives, it says amount of EMS-related incentives that are transferred to the revolver. You mean the
027 fund, which
fund.
Is the ambulance billing fund?
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
So the number that you see a negative on the wage line item on the graphic, like Mr. Jones has pointed out and Mr. LeBrange pointed out. We are actually getting ready to transfer over this year.
Okay.
And I do believe that Ms. Millay told me that, and I looked at it, $77,170.60 will be transferred this year.
I just want to make sure. So it's going into the fund that's raised by fees for the ambulance.
By insurance fees, that's correct. Yes.
Insurance,
the incentives are all paid by that fund.
Okay.
The same one we purchased the supplies and also the ambulance as well.
Yes. Now I'm going to get Chuck all excited. Fireworks detail wages, which is right underneath that. Now, if my recollection serves me right, and Chuck, correct me if you need to, I believe that the selectmen last year waived charging the Hampton Beach Village District for fireworks because you had not had that included in your budget. But usually, traditionally, you have budgeted for the fireworks details, no?
No.
I want to say 12 years ago, maybe longer.
Oh, okay.
We came to the selectmen's meeting and they agreed that it was part of the town's event and they would continue to pay for it.
Okay.
Then it was brought up, but it was never brought up to us. We never had a meeting with the selectman person.
Okay. So, on page 34.
Here, on that point.
What?
On that point.
On that point.
I believe, Chuck, you went to the Board of Selectmen last year and asked them to suspend the fee because you hadn't put it in your budget, and they voted to suspend the fee for 1 year.
Yeah.
And no action has been taken beyond that I'm aware of.
That was my recollection.
Right.
Yeah.
So in 2017, the fee should be in play.
Negative. Believe that it was still responded to the same way, that this was a town function and that they were going to cover it. Initially, last year's cost was defrayed to the 26 fund, which is a special detail fund. So our firefighters that went down to do the inspections and the standby detail were paid out of the 26 fund for the fireworks. This year, we're placing it back into this particular line item with the appropriate increases to cover the cost.
So you're paying for it through the special detail fund, you're saying?
Last year, we did. Because
in 2017, is your expectation to do it again?
No, in 2017, the expectation is it's going to come under the fire department budget.
So we should expect a decrease in the detail fund as a consequence, right? Because you're not using that fund for the fireworks coverage this time around.
So it won't be decreasing, it'll be left alone. This past year, I believe we spent a little over $6,800 on that.
Okay.
It's not okay, but I understand.
Well, on page 34 at the top, Chief, you have diesel fuel. Do you have anything that uses oil and filters? Because that's another segment of the
all of our vehicles do, obviously, and we have vehicle maintenance line item where that's usually taken care of in our preventative maintenance. Deputy Kennedy is actually in charge of preventative maintenance for all of the vehicles, and he takes care, I mean, to the point that you can see that the condition that they're in, they're in exceptional condition.
So we're not going to see oil and filters, but that's part of the maintenance.
That's because that's part of his budget, right, which is...
So we're just seeing gasoline and diesel here. And the same for diesel, Manager Sullivan? You're going to take a look at the diesel prices as well as the,
all the fuel.
Okay.
Just so I can be clear, those fuel lines that we're talking about, the next car, are only for fuel vehicles. Right, so any fuel that a department might use for like a generator or for a chainsaw or anything is a separate deal. Because the taxes can only come off of road vehicles.
Okay. And that's diesel too, gasoline, diesel, whatever.
Yeah. It's pretty much think in terms of the wax car and the data that we're going to analyze for you is only for things with wheels that can drive on the roadway.
Okay.
Other than that, if it's an off-road vehicle or it's a chainsaw or something else, it has to be paid at the pump price or the state price because the taxes are for the driving on the road.
That's a good clarification. Okay.
Excuse me.
New equipment.
Yes, ma'am.
Hydraulic rescue tools for engine 4, ice rescue kits, sled, and the pole system.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm a little concerned about the reduction in that. We do get ice. We do have water.
We do.
We may need to make a rescue. I think that's short-sighted. I don't know if anyone else feels the same way, but I'm not happy about seeing that cut. Now, replacement equipment. That really got me excited. We should not have any 35-year-old hose in the Hampton Fire Department. I have some of those expandable hoses for my garden if you want me to make a donation. I think it's outrageous, outrageous to have 35-year-old hose. Bill, at the A Street Fire, didn't we have a hose problem at that? I seem to remember something at A Street, and there was a problem with the hose. I don't know whether it burst or whatever, but I have a recollection in the back of my mind on that one.
Well, something burned up, but...
You cannot run this fire department. You cannot run a modern fire department with old hose.
Expected life for a fire hose to be deployed is 10 years.
Yes.
Currently, we do have a lot that is 35 years old. When we purchased engine 4, we went out and researched, and Lieutenant Gannon is the one who did the bulk of the research, and he researched the best hose to have friction losses and maneuverability for the firefighters. We ended up buying new hose for engine 4, and this hose has already shown that it's performing very well. The guys like to use it. It's easy to pack. The friction loss is considerably less, which is, you know, it's beneficial when they're fighting a fire. We do test annually our hose, so if something is a problem, we have had burst hose lines, we've had hoses not pass the test, so they're taken out of service. There are still hoses that are in reserve right now that are 35 years old. Many of them are at least 20 years old.
Terrible. So. I don't know how the rest of you feel about that, but I am not happy to see that.
I know the chief thinks he needs new hoses. Do you?
Yeah, and we're gonna see where we stand once we get through the process.
We need new hoses for 2017.
That's the goal.
Yes.
You do. So you need more money to buy those hoses.
Well, like I said, you know, we've gone through the process, and we feel very comfortable that we'll be able to make a decision once we know where we stand on the budget.
Yeah, $14,190 to replace. Now, will that replace all the old hose?
It would outfit three engines.
Okay.
It wouldn't replace all of the reserve hose, but the way we would do it is that we would remove the oldest hose first and replace that, and then the 15-year-old hose would become reserve.
Right. I really got excited when I saw that. Mr. LaBranch.
Yes. So going back to new equipment, you had requested $48,950, and it was reduced to $22,950.
Right.
You have a hydraulic rescue tool, which is what, the Jaws of Life or something?
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Yeah. Okay. And a ice rescue sled that for $79.50, which you've been wanting now for a couple of years.
Yes.
Now, with $22,950, how is that going to... I mean, I can see that you could buy the ice rescue kit for $79.50, but how are you going to get the Jaws of Life? you're simply not going to get it?
We'll have to evaluate it once we get the budget set, but as of right now, you know, making a decision whether or not we get a set of cutters or a set of spreaders, you know, prioritize once we see where we stand.
Okay, so you're gonna do a workaround,
right?
You're comfortable with that?
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's all I need to know. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
What do we do with the hose for him?
Well, again, are you comfortable with doing the workaround?
Yeah, we're gonna eliminate the 35-year-old hose.
Okay, so if he's comfortable with it, then okay. I'm comfortable as well. Yeah. Thank you.
Well, as I understand, the ice rescue kit is no longer something under consideration.
As it stands right now, we're looking to see if we're able to purchase. Actually, next week we're looking to see if we can't purchase an ice rescue sled. Not all of the equipment, but we're looking to do it in shorter segments and smaller pieces. Okay. As we go.
It's what I'm looking at, Chief. Is I guess. These notes are your notes, correct. Right?
Yep.
Right. And so you've got 41,000 for hydraulic rescue tools, and 8,000 essentially for the ice rescue kit, $49,000, which was your request, and then it was cut down to 22,900. And so I don't know how you're going to buy anything with 22,900 when you're looking. Well, maybe you can buy the ice rescue kit, and that's it.
Well,
or maybe two of them.
Right. There's also other accoutrements that go with that, right? Like outfits to get in the water. If you imagine if there's ice in the water, then the guy's going to be really cold, so they need proper gear. So that may not come in this year's purchase. We'll look to do that again.
That's my point. Is these notes are not useful to us in terms of explaining the new equipment line item, because it explains the $49,000 that you requested.
Sure.
As opposed to the $23,000
that Selectman was requesting. You know, the notes and narratives that you see were submitted to the Board of Selectmen and to the town manager in June. And so we go through the process in July and in August and in October.
Right.
So when we get here, some of these are a little bit antiquated because there have been changes along the way.
Okay. Yeah, so one is left to wonder, because one cannot rely on the notes. What are you going to do with the $23,000 that the Board of Selectmen is putting into new equipment?
Prioritize our tasks and purchase what we need.
So we don't know the answer, basically. I don't know.
Well, I don't know what I'm going to be left with at the bottom line for that.
All right, so the answer is I don't know.
I don't know.
Okay, thank you.
Manage his budget as best you can.
All I can ask for is facts, and you give me I don't know. That's a fact.
However, doing the ice rescue or whatever, just buying a sled, and then you have supplement in 2 years.
It's not for us to
whatever.
Prioritize anyway.
It seems to me that's more dangerous than having nothing if you have a nice sled but not the other equipment to go with it.
It's
a concern, too.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, enough. All right, does anyone else have...
Yes, you know, I was talking about the fireworks thing.
Yes, sir.
You said it was paid last year under the special details?
Correct.
Can you guide me as to where the special details are? I don't see that line item.
Line 26, Fund 26, which you know that...
Well, it's a separate fund. It's not in the budget.
That's
it's a separate
right.
fund. Do you know the status of that fund?
I don't.
Well, you get the printout on the back of the monthly reports.
I don't believe it reports the status of funds.
Yes, fund is Fund 26, which is, you probably recognize it more as the police detail fund.
Ah, so you took it out of police.
Are also a part of that, a very small part of it. That's where it came out.
So the police detail fund is funded by the forfeiture stuff, right?
By what, sir?
By the forfeiture stuff that we do.
Funded by details that are paid by companies.
Okay, revenue.
And, right. Exactly. It's the revenue that comes from that.
Okay. And is there any reason why we couldn't continue to use that fund to fund the fireworks from the fire department?
Just have to be cautious of how much, because this is a non-replaceable thing.
Right.
Well, I'm talking about $7,500, according to the budget. Yeah.
But then the police has their issues as well, so the decision was made, if this is a service that we're going to provide, to put it in the budget. If you want to make some other decision, you certainly can.
Right. Okay, are you ready for the bottom line, which was moved at $2,598,152, I think?
No. $2,559,127 was moved by Mr. Jones.
Yeah, that was my motion. One final comment, Madam Chair.
Wait a minute. $2,559,127. Thank you.
Since we're moving this to final review, I will have my ears open as to why I shouldn't remove that $7,500 and let the detail fund handle that, as it did successfully last year. And I'm also open to my ears to restoring the new equipment line item. So I will take that into consideration in final review, which is what this motion is moving your budget to.
Thank you, sir. I'll second.
I already seconded it.
Oh, we have
second.
Okay. All right. In favor of the total fire suppression?
We're unanimous. No, Ginny's going to contradict me.
I am, because they if you want to put that $26,000 in, you should do it.
Well,
really, a guy in the water is not going to wait until another year where they can get...
I'm inclined to listen to the argument and other people that have wisdom to give it to me or us, but right now I'm not convinced as to what to do on those two points. So we'll do it at final review.
This is to take us to final review, and we will review. And I have share your concerns, Jenny.
And this is also, but if we put the $26,000 in the budget, there's no guarantee that's
correct.
Will go, because we're approving a bottom line budget, not a line item.
Yeah, I know.
That's a
larger nut that can't be cracked. I understand.
Try it again. In favor of the motion to get this to our final review, unanimous.
Okay. Madam Chair, I move fire prevention.
$105,302
to final review.
I will second that.
Okay. And this takes you through fire prevention. Wait a minute. Okay. Well, I'm working on two different lines here. So your bottom line for fire prevention is what again?
$105,302.
Page 36. 36. Okay. Right at the top of the page, obviously. Questions? In favor? Unanimous. Okay. Training. Medical services, new equipment.
Yeah, I'll move $37,978.
And I will second it.
Thank you, Steve.
You're welcome.
Wait a minute. Where are you? Total training.
I'm on page 36.
I'm seeing 73.
That's because you're looking at
the
number.
That's why. Okay. Well, that's why I need you guys.
Right.
Motion again is.
I am moving $37,978 to final review consideration.
Right.
For training.
And who seconded it?
I did.
Okay.
I seconded.
Seconded by Mr. LeBranch. In favor.
Wait.
Of moving it forward. Okay.
Unanimous. Good.
Madam Chair, I'd like to move under fire communication $236,304 to final review consideration.
$236,304. Okay. Your radios and stuff working better now?
Since we've installed the FDDA circuits, we've noticed a dramatic increase in
people can actually call you now.
Absolutely.
And reach you.
We are. We're still having problems at the beach, as you might imagine. It's very flat down there. And radios work in a line of sight type of manner, so it's difficult to hit with a portable.
Yeah.
We're actually working on upgrading the system as much as possible, and in conjunction with Lieutenant Goditis of the police department, we're looking at a projected changeover or upgrade to the system between 2018 and 2020.
Excellent. Okay. All right, you understand the intent. In favor?
I have a question.
You have a question, Mike?
Yes. On the line item 4310, you've got the radio maintenance going from actual 3311 to 16 up to request up to 15,666. So I was just curious what caused that big jump.
There's several requirements that go along with the new FDDA circuits. One of them is a monthly charge. As you might recall, when we were here last time, we were discussing the two-wire system that Alexander Graham Bell had invented, connected our voter system, which is our antennas. The FDDA circuits are four-wire digital system that is monitored, so there's a monthly cost that goes along with that. That has been placed in that line item for radio maintenance, along with we had a couple of other items that needed to be adjusted because of our maintenance moving forward. That's right. We moved the repeater and the comparator from Falcone Circle to the fire station.
Oh.
So that's actually down here now, which gives us the opportunity. First of all, it's weathertight and safer that way, but it also gives us the opportunity for our fire alarm operators to go in and see if there's a problem. If one of the voters is offline, they'll be able to see it and address it immediately.
So right now, I guess the question, would be, you budgeted $12,502. And you've only spent $3,311 so far as of 9/30 this year.
Yeah, and I can guarantee you that number's changed since.
Okay, so you think you might come close?
Okay. Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir.
I have a question on that same subline. You said it was monitoring. There's a cost of that monitoring. What does that cost?
Off the top of my head, I believe it's $514 a month. right? Yeah. Is that right? $514 a month.
$6,000 a year.
Yes.
$6,258.
To monitor.
Yes.
And repair.
But you have to understand.
Not just to monitor, right?
They will repair it. That's their line item. Where the idea behind monitoring, the voters are actually antenna. And so they're dispersed strategically throughout the community. For an unknown period of time, two of the voter systems with the wires that connect to what was once our repeater over at Falcon Circle were down, and we had no idea. We had poor radio communications, but we didn't know why. So they went out and had to research it and find the circuit was down. Now, immediately, they'll know, because they're monitoring it, if the circuit goes down, they'll go out and address the problem immediately so that we'll have upgraded communications, and if we're on the scene, they'll know that that line is down immediately.
And they'll repair it without charge?
I believe that it is, yeah.
Excellent. $6,000 a year.
Correct.
We don't have to worry about that element of radio maintenance anymore.
That's right.
Okay, so that explains
one-third of what?
Of your budget, which is $15,000.
Well, radio maintenance is an overall task, too. I mean, we have portable radios that need to be maintained. We use speaker mics, which are on our portable radios. Mm-hmm. You see them all lapel mics. Frequently, those go down, whether it's the wire fraying or breaking. Those are $109 a piece to replace. As it stands right now, we're looking forward at Seabrook Fire, who we do backup communications for. They just changed to their own frequency. And so we have to reprogram portables and also mobile radios to take the new frequency, which is a significant cost. It's over $1,000 to have them all reprogrammed. So that radio maintenance line item also encompasses a great deal of radio maintenance, actual portables, mobiles, and base stations.
So it sounds like a big portion of that is actually buying new radios when they're just not repairable, is that it?
No, not really, because we haven't purchased a new portable since I've been here, actually.
So it's actual repair?
Actual repairs.
Okay. And they're not done by your staff, but by someone?
No, sir, we use a company outside.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir.
Good. Okay. Are we set on... Now I'm flipping from page to page. We're set on the training at $37,978.
No, no. We already did that.
We're doing communications.
Communications.
Have we voted?
Yeah, we did vote on training.
Okay.
So we're
ready to communications vote. Now. Let's get this proper. $236,304?
Yes, ma'am.
Mm-hmm. Oh, regular wages, overtime wages, telephone, et cetera. Chief, go ahead.
We just finished that.
We just finished it.
No, we're ready to vote.
We're ready to vote on that.
Communications.
We just did
wait a minute.
Have to vote
we did
on
training. Now we should be on communications.
Right. We had a motion. We just discussed it.
We talked about radios.
Yes, but the last motion I had was 37,978 under training.
No. That was training.
Okay, so we are doing the 236,304.
Right. I moved, Stephen seconded, and we've been discussing.
I got it right here. Okay. Everybody in favor? You love all the radios and stuff. Good.
We're unanimous.
There you go.
Madam Chair, I'd like to move repair services under the fire department for $127,150 to the final review.
I'll second that.
Seconded by Mr. LaBranch.
Okay.
In favor? Overtime wages.
Well, I have to wonder under repair services why maintenance repair is not under repair services.
That's for communications equipment and repair services that you're seeing right there is typically vehicle maintenance and also the repairs that occur down at the pier. So we have to winterize, as you might imagine. We have water and electric that's supplied to the state pier, and we have to winterize that. So that time, over the course of several storms, we had some of the rubber bumpers, and I know that Lieutenant Wise is going to hit me for saying it like that, but some of the rubber bumpers on the dock had to be replaced this year, so there was time spent down there. The vehicle maintenance side of the house, we know that there are anticipated cost increases. We've been told that anywhere between 5 and 15% on labor and on parts for different vehicles and different manufacturers.
So the vehicle maintenance actually includes PIER, P-I-E-R.
Correct. To some degree. So the $1,500 that you see for the overtime, if there's repairs to be made, that comes out of that line item. There is a separate section for pier maintenance. You'll see, I believe it's 6305, which is in the next section, and that is for parts and utilities that are necessary for that.
That's the end of the budget.
Yeah, right. You requested $6,000 for pier maintenance, and the town manager said, no, you only need $5,000.
I projected that.
What do we lose?
We lost not much, but we lost painting, to be honest with you. Some painting and some of the undressed maintenance items that have been going deferred for a long time. So there's a shack down there that it's a shed that's been built to house equipment. That equipment is PFDs, right? Personal flotation devices and gear like that. It's a little bit weathered. We were looking to repaint this year, and we may have to defer that.
Well, maybe you can get the Village District Beautification Committee to paint it for you.
That would be a wonderful idea.
There you go. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Okay. Boy, I got so excited. All right. Are you ready for the vote on repair services 127-150? In favor?
Madam Chair, I'll move.
Wait a minute, because I want to make sure that
we're unanimous.
Barbara is. Got that, my dear? Okay.
Fire stations and buildings.
Fire stations and buildings.
$112,870.
I'll second that.
To final review.
Thanks, Steve. Barbara, did you get that number?
112870.
Yes.
Okay.
Exactly.
You understand the intent there. Chief, where it says heating fuel, I assume that's gas.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, heat. Yeah. Okay.
Natural gas.
Mm-hmm.
All set? Ready for that?
Yeah.
Okay, in favor? 112-870.
Unanimous.
Now, confirming. So we have made no changes at this point in time.
Correct. So I'll move the total fire department for $3,000,000. $549,446 to the Budget Committee's final review session.
I'll second that.
And you understand the intent. Okay, in favor?
Can you help me out with that again?
Okay, $3,549,446.
All in favor? Unanimous.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for what you do.
Thank you, Chief.
Thank you, Deputy Chief.
We will have a final review, and you will be advised.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. Chief Sawyer and Deputy Hobbs. Well, the descriptions for both budgets were well done, so it made it easy to follow.
Welcome, Chief. Welcome, Deputy.
Good evening,
gentlemen. Chair, if I might just move the.
What I want to do is hit rolling stock first.
All right.
So we don't forget it at the end.
Okay.
Good. And we've got a lot of stuff.
Does that include roller blades?
Be careful.
What do you like, Jim? Hey,
be careful, Tim.
In the back of the budget, you've got your rolling stock.
Which one is it? Do you remember?
I know I have a couple of questions.
It's under Appendix
E. No, it doesn't. Yes,
E. Appendix E.
Okay, I'm real close then. Thank you.
Now, you haven't put here what the fire chief put, showing poor, excellent, whatever. So maybe you could give us a little guidance.
I
flagged some of the vehicles. Number 304, the 2007 Crown Vic. Is that coughing and sputtering, or?
Actually, that's not too bad. What you find, that's a 2007 Crown Vic. That's an admin vehicle. What you find with the admin vehicles is fewer drivers, means better wear and tear on the vehicle. But what you find out with our admin vehicles is, in my career with Hampton PD, I've seen four vehicles that were admin vehicles that don't get the current, they don't get the mileage as quick.
Yeah.
The frames rust because of the salt air environment. So I've seen four of them because of the frames go out of service because of that issue. So that car is in fairly decent shape, but I think that's one of the ones we're planning on removing from our inventory.
Okay.
Here, either this year, at the end of this year, or the beginning of next.
And you got your two new vehicles, the Ford Explorers. Just got them. I think I watched you the other night, and those are the new.
Three new ones just came in. That was part of the 16 budget.
Oh, there it is on the bottom.
Yeah, we took a different track. Usually, we have the budgets in the vehicles in during the summer, and Lieutenant Gidwe had a great idea. When we do that in the summertime, we tie up a vehicle for a few days with a changeover because you have to change over the all the components of the vehicle you're getting rid of, and that can take a couple of days. And in the middle of the summer, where we're busy with operations and detail, that really limits our vehicle fleet. So we decided to place the order later in the year, get the vehicles in later in the year, so it keeps the summer miles off.
Yeah.
and the transition doesn't impact the operations much. So.
And you've got 2016s rather than 2017s because you've got a little break, I hope, maybe?
I think actually we got the 17s. And I don't think there was much of a change in price. I could be wrong on that, though.
I'm seeing
the new ones.
2016s.
On the new ones?
Well, I don't see new ones if they're not.
They literally just came in.
This was before they were purchased.
Rolling stock you have is prior to those coming in.
Okay, right? So the new ones that came in replaced what?
They haven't been replaced yet because we're still in the middle of the transition, so I can't.
Well, I know, but what units will they be replaced?
I would say it's probably your higher mileage cars, the 318.
318.
Which is your parking enforcement vehicle, okay. Which has 113,000 miles on. Pretty sure that's okay. One of the one that's going right out the door.
And just for future reference, I want to see what you're getting rid of.
Yeah. Well, that's kind of a fluid decision, though. We're looking at assessing vehicles.
Still working on it? Okay.
Well, it's one of those things. When we get under a vehicle, we look, we may say, you know, this one's in better shape than that one, so okay. Let's keep this one, even though it's got a few more miles.
Okay. We'll stay tuned.
I'm not trying to be mean. I'm just trying to figure out what you got.
No, that's a good question.
And your ATVs look pretty decent, I guess, because it doesn't say poor or anything.
No, they're pretty well kept up. They utilize them quite a bit, but they're required to also clean them off every time they bring them in.
You got your trailers. And on the bottom...
Those ATVs are used exclusively for the beat patrol, right?
I would say 99%. There are those opportunities where we may have to go somewhere. I can't recall any recently, but you know, we have the rail bed now out there. That's if we have to get out there, that we'd use that. Or into White's Lane, we'd use those.
Yeah.
I can't remember a recent history where we've done that, but I know in the past we have. So I'd say 99% is down at the beach.
Okay, good. And then at the bottom, the variable message, those are the messages.
Big orange ugly things that are all rusting, yes, those are them.
So it looks good. It doesn't look like anything is falling apart. I don't see
We're a little different than the fire department. Yeah. They hold on to their vehicles a lot longer because of the size and obviously the cost, and they're able to house those in covered facilities where ours are out a little bit more exposed. So you get about, on average, 3 years out of a patrol vehicle.
Okay, so I just wanted to review that. It doesn't look like anything terrible, and you're taking care of the new vehicles that you managed to purchase before the end of this year, but they will be 2017.
I don't know if the manufactured date is 17 or 16, but they're part of the 16 budget.
Okay,
Madam
good.
Chair.
Yes, sir.
I can move the police administration for $501,000.
Wait. No, you're getting way ahead of the thing here. Animal control is next.
No. Animal control comes after me, and then.
No. We did rolling stock, and then we got animal control, which is a no-brainer, and it comes under the police department. What?
Police administration is my motion for $502,814.
I will second that.
The animal control, ma'am, comes under Health and Human Services. It's actually a separate budget from the police. We separated that a few years back.
We held this.
I don't know. We're going to do it tonight.
Okay,
afterwards.
We'll do it tonight. We don't want to forget budget. The animals.
I won't let you forget.
All right. Okay. You've got to be good to Peter.
Okay, so the motion is, you have the number, Barbara, 502-814.
Administration. Gasoline, the dreaded gasoline. Now, it doesn't have a price, but I'm assuming... Mr. Sullivan, that's a 195 as well. It was factored in at 195 like the fire.
They're all the same. Yes,
they're all the same. Okay. And plain gasoline, not diesel.
Do you use diesel?
The
only thing we use diesel in is in our light towers. The towers are diesel powered.
Gotcha.
Not a building generator.
Okay. Now, questions on this section of the budget. Training and recruitment, rentals and leases, all that stuff. I have a couple of questions if nobody else does. Okay, regular wages. You all got your sheet from July when the selectmen made their gave out their increases for non-union. 10% for the chief, which was an extra $10,000. Deputy chief and administrative assistant, 5% each. I didn't see any raises other than the standard 2% for the fire chief, for the public works director, for the a director of Parks and Recreation, who is the longest serving.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
The Board of Selectmen made a singular motion to increase.
I know they did, but I'm trying to figure out what was unique here that resulted in higher wage increases than in the other non-union personnel. I think it's a valid question.
The biggest chunk was the police chief's raise of $10,000, which was a singular motion made in July.
Which backdated to April 1st.
By the Board of Selectmen.
Yes.
And they said that they were basing that on some analysis that the assistant town manager had done about salary competitiveness, I believe, or something to that effect.
That's correct.
But I guess the assistant town manager could speak more intelligent than that, because I don't know anything more than that.
Go ahead.
You have a question? Yes, so far everything you said is accurate. Yes, the Board of Selectmen has adjusted these wages based on an analysis that was presented to them. They intend to adjust some other wages in the 17 budget that are in the merit line or in that adjustment line.
Right.
But yes, that's what the board did.
But what was unique about this department, because all of the other non-union individuals received 2%. So that's what I'm trying to get at. I'd just like to understand where this came from. I did watch that meeting.
Sure. So Board of Selectmen chose, when I did my analysis, presented to the board, there were several positions, a number of positions of the non-unions that appeared to be, based on my comparativeness, either substantially below or below. And the board decided to address three of those in July, to address three more in the 2017 budget. So what they did was, in general, across the board to non-unions,
right. They
did a 2%.
Except for the building inspector, right.
There were three others that they did, the chief, the deputy, and the administrative assistant.
Correct.
For what you've described.
Right.
And then in addition, there were a couple of others. There was, in a contract, one that I think was 5% off the top of my head for the deputy director of DPW, but that was part of her initial hiring documentation.
Right.
And that's what the board voted for this year. Later in the year, they voted to adjust the town manager's salary and my salary.
Right.
Those are what you've discussed so far tonight.
So
the $10,000 raise the police chief received, and we're dealing with the police budget only, so...
Right.
The 2% non-union wage, did he also get a kick in that?
He
had a singular increment of $10,000, and that's it. Nothing else.
Those that received a wage adjustment, as described, did not get the double. They didn't get that plus one or the other.
Right, so he got a singular increment. It was $10,000 flat.
Okay. I think the percentage, it was 10,000 flat, that's correct. The other percentage.
Yes. That's on the list that we received.
Like 9.73 technically
it
was.
Exactly what it is, 9.73. We're looking at a budget that says 4.5% increase in regular wages under police administration, right? And that 4.5% is based on the budget, not on the actuals. Is that right, Christy?
Yes.
So,
I mean, there's been...
Am I to understand that's simply a meaningless number to us? Because you increase the pay in the case of the chief. You also increase the deputy, I believe, right?
Yeah.
But I'm picking on the chief because he's the chief. And he's got the bigger number. But... Just for simplicity's sake, we increased him by $10,000, and of course that's going to flow into next year.
Yes.
Okay. And the same with the deputy chief and others.
Yeah.
And so that raise that was done in 2016, this year, could actually have caused this 4% increase in the 2017 budget, right?
Yes. Yes.
Right. So that means there's no wage increases for the chief or anyone else in the police administration for a raise in 2017, correct?
No.
That is not.
No.
Okay.
So, again, you have two separate things. In this line item, what you're looking at is what is the wage before any adjustment in 2017?
Right.
So that's what that number is. That 4%, 4.5% that you're seeing is the increase of that line item as comparison to the last year.
In 2016.
Right.
To
answer your question, as we spoke earlier, the current Board of Selectmen has authorized a 2% wage adjustment, and there are three other positions identified to have a larger than 2% wage adjustment as a part of that analysis from before.
But the point is that there is no targeted raises here.
No, I want to be very clear on something. When you look at the breakdown, what's in administration, it's the chief, the the deputy chief.
The administrative assistant.
The administrative assistant, but it also includes the prosecutor. Right. So the prosecutor is a union employee. Right. And if you recall last year...
Right, we're only talking non-union here, though.
I know, but you're talking about administration line, though, and he's included in the administration line as far as salary. So you will see a contractual raise based on...
You know what that number is?
I think it's 3% off the top of my head, but don't also remember there's also step raises. I don't know if Sergeant Reno would be due a step this year or not, but there'll definitely be a 3% to Sergeant Reno based on the contract.
It was so in 2017, there are no targeted raises for non-union police administration. Is that an accurate statement?
On that regular
police administration, this line item, that is correct.
Thank you. Take it away, Steve.
Okay. I have some questions additionally. I looked through the 2015 annual report, which does have a listing of all the salaries and all the employees. And I noticed something that I hadn't really paid much attention to previously. And that is, let's see, in 1997, the then Board of Selectmen made an adjustment in the police department because the police department was restructured. And from lieutenant on up, the positions were salaried. I am seeing overtime charges and funds and grants being charged to the chief of this department, and I'm wondering how that fits in. You, when I went back and looked at you and your service as chief of police, there were a couple of overtime entries, but there was very little by way of anything other than your flat salary. Well, I went back. Now, I'm looking for 2015 at a salary of $107,785. That was before the adjustment that we just discussed. Funds and grants, $7,394, and overtime, $4,820. I'm just curious as to how this is translating, because I'm not accustomed to seeing the chief's position as other than salaried, and the deputy, and same thing for the other departments.
If I may, you made a statement earlier that the lieutenants were just salaried. That's not accurate. They're an hourly employee. They have overtime. They do other things. Your issue of what you're talking about for the deputy chief and the chief are straight salary positions.
Right.
Okay, they're exempted positions.
Right.
And yes, I very rarely work some of those.
Correct. True.
Yeah, I very rarely did. This chief works more of them. Yes. You're eligible to. If there's availability and they're open, you're available to do so.
If I might, ma'am, it's a very common practice. You'll see chiefs throughout the area that work details. I knew this was an issue that you might be concerned with, and I checked, and it's a very common thing for chiefs to work. I probably work more hours than most of the ones on the Seacoast, but then again, I think we also probably have more need for it with the number of events we run down here. We are event central. I think a lot of the things you see me working are those type of things.
Is this detracting from the ability of the part-time special officers to earn?
Very clearly, I want to make this clear.
Well, I thought I'd ask.
By contract, the work most of the work that we have has to be offered to community members first, which includes special officers.
Yes.
The only ones that wouldn't be is if we have a large event, such as the Seafood Festival, where we require a command officer to be present during the operation. Those are specifically for command people.
Right.
But in those bigger events, frequently we can't fill them anyhow, and they wind up going to outside agencies anyhow. So in a short sum, though, if there's a road job for somebody to work, the last people that are eligible to work that, unlike other agencies, is the command staff. You go to Salem PD, chief of police gets first call, deputy chief, and down the row. So we do it inversely. A first-year part-time officer gets a crack at work, that extra work,
So you're first working off the union call list?
Yes.
Okay. How many members of the Hampton Police Department, to the best of your knowledge, work details in other communities?
I would have to do an assessment for that because, again, we're reciprocal with other agencies. So if we have an event down here, a large road race or the seafood festival, we'll call UNH, Seabrook, the other agencies that we work with. And conversely, I know the last couple of weeks we've been working a lot in Seabrook. It really depends where the work is at that given moment. Some years, the gas company was working in Hampton for the last 2 years a lot. Now there's a lot of road work down on the area of 107 down in Seabrook, so you'll see our officers down there working. To say how much we're working elsewhere, I really don't have an answer off the top of my head on that.
As head of the department, do you feel that it inhibits your ability to manage the department by taking details or whatever?
No, I'm very careful about how I do that. I think you'll find the details that I take are on weekends when I'm not normally working or during the evening hours. Now, my schedule is flexible. I adjust it to attend meetings such as this, mm-hmm. whatever I have to do. But I try not to take any type of extra work. I had the opportunity Monday before the election. The University of New Hampshire was desperately looking for officers to come up as they were experiencing a presidential visit. They asked if I would come up. They are very fond of the Hampton Police Department coming up there because of our expertise in dealing with crowd control situations. I determined that that wasn't appropriate for me to do. I had other things going on in town. I had some meeting stuff that I had to attend, so I declined to take that work. And that's normally my practice. I can't think of a time I've taken a detail Monday through Friday where I would normally be in my office working, primarily evenings and weekends.
So you coordinate with Deputy Hobbs if you're going to be out of town, or he's going to be out of town, vice versa. There's one of you there to respond to whatever might be happening in town.
I wouldn't say just out of town. I'd say out of the area.
The area.
If I'm going to go, say I'm going to UNH, I don't feel that that's that far out of the area. He generally knows where I am.
Well, that's what I'm...
Yeah. Okay, generally we speak.
So you two are coordinating.
As much as we can.
Okay. Okay, I know I've sidetracked you, but I had questions, and so I
asked. I have a question.
Sure.
Yes.
You said you're a salaried employee.
Yes.
So if you're salaried, how can you collect overtime? I'm lost in that.
It's generally not...
General nature of what my...
Considered, when we work for an outside source of money, being a private vendor, an event, or if it's a grant...
Like the Seacoast Festival.
Seafood Festival is paid for by the Chamber of Commerce. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And one of the things we've done, I think we've done very well, is... saving money to the taxpayer as far as providing police officers for special events. We really can't do that. A, we don't have the people to do it and the funding to do it. So when you want to run a special event in Hampton, and there are many, you have to sit down with us, fire department, and public works to determine what's the safest thing to do, and we determine what the public safety needs are. Those things are then billed to the private entity for the rate of pay, for the detail rate, and our rate of pay is $35 an hour or the officer's overtime rate, whichever is greater. Then there's a 30% charge on top of that for administrative things such as insurance costs and retirement costs. And we also charge a fee, I think it's $14 an hour if you utilize a cruiser vehicle. So that's the revenue stream for that Fund 26 we were talking about earlier. So those aren't considered by, I believe IRS, Christy, you probably answer this better. It's not considered overtime. It's a separate entity in itself.
So it's not being paid by the Hampton taxpayers. It's being paid by the Seafood Festival.
Right. If I work a detail, I'm paid by the town, but then the town is reimbursed by that entity plus the
30%. Thank you. I've got a question.
Sonny?
When I see the flashing blue lights for the construction site, doesn't the battery run down? Or are they running their engine?
They'll be running their engine.
That's driving up the cost of gas then.
Well, you're getting 30% again. I don't know if you heard that.
That's for you to...
you get the 30%, but also if you have a cruiser, you get $14 an hour more if we utilize a cruiser.
That's what I always wondered.
Good question.
Okay, Mr. Pierce?
When you go up to Durham, is that a detail rate?
Yes.
The university reimburses the town?
University has been, we went up for an early season meeting The university, this is, I think, their 150th year. They're celebrating a big anniversary. So all of their events, they're doubling up their police coverage, plus they are a hotbed of political activity in an election year. So our officers are going up there very frequently. We have 6 officers going up on Saturday night for an event. And they're trying to utilize agencies like Hampton and Laconia that are used to dealing with crowd control situations.
So they do pay us for it then?
Yes, they do.
Okay.
Plus the 30%.
Thank you. That is my question.
I have a question.
Tim? Oh, I'm sorry.
I just have a quick one. For something like this event, does the horse earn any pay? Do you send the horse up there?
We really haven't gone out of town with the horses in a while. The last time, I mean, a lot of people remember we were up there back in 2004 when we were anticipating UNH was in the finals, and back then the sports riots were a big thing. They were going across nationally, and we had a sports riot. The Mounted was very effective at that time, but I can't recall us going to a special event like that at the request. Now, the Mounted will use them in the town of Stratham, celebrated a big birthday. They asked for them to be in their parade, so I did not bill them for that. I absorbed that as a cost of just mutual aid. Mm-hmm. I looked at that as more as a mutual aid situation. But if there was an issue where somebody needed for crowd control, we would send them, but we would bill. Although, considering we charge $14 an hour for the car, I don't know what I would charge for the horse. We might have to come up with a formula for that. I don't know.
I just didn't know, because it's something that...
I'd be happy if they clean up the poop, but we don't have to.
Rent a horse fee.
Yeah, we'd have to. That's one I haven't had, so that's a good question.
And maybe a training place for him as well, or an officer.
Yeah, thank you.
Sonny?
Another question. The special detail race the same from town to town?
No, they vary because keep in mind where we
raise your rates.
We live in a mixed area. We live in a mixed area of union shops and non-union shops. So one of the, you know, we utilize Seabrook a lot. They're right next door. They work with us. So I always try to give them and UNH first crack at the work. Now they have collective bargaining agreements with their particular entities, so it's governed by that. So if we work somewhere else, like if we go to Seabrook, we charge them based upon our rate. If Seabrook comes to Hampton to work, they charge based on their rate, and that's the agreement. Because if we try to get a Seabrook officer to accept the pay that Hampton has, it may be different than his contract. So to avoid any union conflicts amongst the agencies, we've just all agreed that Hampton charges Hampton rate, Seabrook charges Seabrook rate, and that way I don't get involved with any of the billing or any of the issues that if a Seabrook officer comes to Hampton. Seafood Fest paid, I believe, 6 different law enforcement agencies for the details to cover that 3-day event. They all sent separate bills. Rockingham Sheriff, State Police, Seabrook, and any of the other agencies that work, they send a separate bill to the vendor, just like it happened in their town. It's just cleaner and easier, because that would be impossible for finance to track that if we did it any other way.
All set? All worked up here?
No.
Mr. Jones?
Chief, you got a 10% increase, 10.11% increase in overtime wages. It's including the deputy, or salary, obviously, doesn't apply to you as specified. Mm-hmm. On page 20, for those who are playing the budget committee at home.
Yep.
So you've got overtime for administrative personnel, summer, prosecutor support. And some other thing about computer development and repair. Mm-hmm. How much computer development and repair charges occurred in this line item last year?
Specific to that portion of it, I can't answer that off the top of my head. Basically, we've taken a couple of officers. As you remember, Lieutenant Goditis does the primary work on our computer system. But he can't be there 24/7. He goes on vacation. He's not out there to midnight. So we've trained up a couple of officers that if he's not available, and a lot of times it happens on shift, sometimes it doesn't. Somebody has to come in and reboot the computers and reset things that fail down in dispatch. And that, I believe, is the crux of that money. How much is spent specifically on that?
It's got to be rather small. I mean,
it's a small
5 minutes to push the button.
$5,347 to
I'm the wrong guy to ask about. I think we've had this discussion.
Yeah.
I'm not the guy to ask about computers.
But $5,347, Tim, to date in that line.
Thank you.
Right on the cover sheet.
It's a 10% increase from last year. I'm wondering how you calculated a 10% increase.
Well, keep in mind,
though, it didn't come from the notation on computer development and repair. It came apparently from overtime for administrative personnel.
Yeah.
Well, they have touched on that. Sergeant Reno, as far as prosecution goes, got a 3% raise based on the contract in 16.
That, okay.
3% raise coming in 17, which is this budget, plus any step he may have done. But also, when you look at the computer stuff, those officers that worked at also, 3, whatever step raise they got. So that would incorporate that increase.
Could we get some visibility on that notation, pushing the button, and how much that costs when we need to rebuild the computers?
The officer's overtime rate.
Right. I mean, how often is that done and that kind of thing?
I could try to find out.
Yeah, I appreciate
how often
that.
We do that.
Because I'll take a look at that at final review, maybe.
Okay.
So I'd rather just say, yeah, it's cool. I looked at the background and it's okay.
Right.
But right now it's kind of a black thing, black box. Now you get an automobile for 24/7 access.
Yes.
Correct. And your deputy does as well?
Yes.
Okay. And the town policy has you having access to that to go wherever 24/7 because we expect you to be available 24/7.
Correct.
Right. And so, if you're on detail out of town, then you're not available.
No. You're inaccurate.
Oh. So you're going to run away from the detail and you're going to come into town?
It's happened.
So that will happen. That will occur.
We were up at UNH.
Yeah, I don't need an example. I just want to know that
you asked
that will
the question.
Occur. That will occur, right?
It has happened.
I'd like to hear the example.
We were up at a concert up at the Whittemore Center back last spring. And we had an incident occur where we believed we were going to have an activation of the tactical team, which I also serve as president of. A number of the officers there were part of the team, were on the detail. I let the captain know at UNH that I had an incident occurring, that I had to relieve the several officers to return. And then I shortly after I felt it was safe there, that they had adequate staffing there, I left and came back and handled the incident. So that has occurred.
So there was a delay in getting back. While you're waiting for staff to
It's a bit of a drive from Durham here, yeah, but that was the delay.
Well, that's the reason why we give you a car 24/7, so that there will be no delay in getting transportation
I guessed him.
That's my understanding of why you have the 24/7 car.
Well, if you use your model, then apparently...
Not my model. I think that's the selectman from years ago decided the chief and the deputy chief need a car because they have to be on call and on scene, lickety-split when we need them. That was the reason why.
How do we handle it, Tim, when I'm out of town on personal business? Am I now restricted to the boundaries of the town of Hampton?
No, I think that vacation time and sick time is implicitly excluded from that.
Training,
of course, is part of your function. Yeah, sure.
So you don't.
But deriving income from a secondary source, I don't think that is implicit.
Mutual aid, helping out.
Well, mutual aid is different.
Mutual aid is not private details, Brian.
Okay.
Sonny?
I got a couple.
So am I confused on this?
Wait one second.
I think on a
when I say, look, at, I'm okay with the chief doing police details. Mm-hmm. I'm okay with the deputy chief doing police details, as long as they're like still available to be on scene, like they split. So I don't expect the chief to go do a police detail in Las Vegas, for example.
I have two.
Well, that doesn't get you on scene. That's
no, but most of the things I do, okay.
The phone does not get you on scene.
No, it doesn't, Tim. I agree with you. Okay, but a lot of what I do is this, okay? I could be in Epping. We've been called out 5 times by the tactical team in the last 8 weeks, okay? So I'm all over the place, frequently, okay? We still have the town of Hampton to protect, okay? So would you advocate that we cancel mutual aid with other communities? And that we don't be part of the Seacoast Emergency Response Team, because that's kind of where you're going with it.
No, it is not. I said,
I said
deriving income from a secondary source. You do not derive income from a mutual aid activity.
Okay.
Right? So I wasn't referring to that at all.
Well, I consider the details also mutual aid because...
Well, they're not.
Well, I think the chiefs of police would disagree.
If they were mutual aid, then you wouldn't be deriving any income from the activity.
Not necessarily.
That's not true.
Private details are private details.
Tim, you're missing the point. You're so missing the point.
So when
we call in the Seacoast Emergency...
When I have a private party...
Am I going to be allowed to speak?
when I have a private party.
Apparently not.
When I have a private party and I hire a police detail. Okay. Is that mutual aid? That policeman that shows up to my house at my party, is he performing mutual aid?
I think that's a question. That's a question that's not even worthy of a response to.
Right, because it's a private detail. Private detail and mutual aid are not the same thing. They're not interchangeable.
Oh, and sometimes they are.
Please explain.
University of New Hampshire, when they have a major event, or when the town of Hampton has a major event, and we can't fulfill what we need to provide for public safety, okay, I can't extend a private detail to an entity I don't have mutual aid with. So how you can sit there and claim that isn't the fact flies in the face of the law. I can't extend a private detail to a police agency that I don't have mutual aid with. So how you can sit there and say that they're not somehow related is just beyond my comprehension. I don't know what you're talking about.
I didn't say there's not a relationship between the entities.
I think you did.
I said there's not a relationship between the two activities. Mutual aid is an activity that's taking place at our expense because we, in fact, when we go help out Seabrook, right? We don't send a bill to Seabrook because we also know that they'll come and help us out and they won't send a bill to us. That's mutual aid, right?
Yeah. But it's also in those circumstances where details have to be paid. Yeah. Because I cannot invite in Seabrook PD to work an event in Hampton or the University of New Hampshire unless I have a mutual aid with them. So
but
to try to claim they're mutually exclusive is inaccurate.
The activity itself is either a private detail or it's mutual aid, right?
No, sometimes it's one and the same.
Can we move
this
along?
It can be both.
Oh, okay.
I do have a question before you move along.
Go ahead, and then...
It started with the cruisers. So my question is, when you go to UNH, you drive the cruiser up to UNH?
Yes.
If your regular patrolmen have a detail at UNH, do they take a cruiser up to UNH?
It would depend on what the need of the detail was. There are details sometimes that are traffic control that need a cruiser. So a cruiser would be sent in the private vendor will be built for the cruiser. There are ones where you're just standing in the roadway, it doesn't require a cruiser, so they'll drive there in their own vehicle. It depends on the different nature of the vehicle as to whether that would happen or not.
Thank you.
Sonny? Could I ask for a vote?
Wait one second, because poor Sonny has been trying to do one follow-up.
When the EMTs go out, they send a fire engine. Would it be cheaper to send a cruiser along?
The fire department. We're talking about the police now.
In what area? I'm not positive what you're asking.
I'm sorry.
I'm not quite sure what you're asking me.
Oh, well, when the ambulance goes out, a fire truck goes out with it.
That's operational necessity.
What they say is in case they need the extra help. Okay.
Now, you're talking about just any private detail in town or out of town? If I had all those cars, yeah, I would agree. But we have times here in the summertime where I could have 8 or 9 people on details. I can't take 8 or 9 cruisers to work details and deplete my workforce of the patrol function. So it all depends. Again, there's a lot of details where an officer can just stand in the intersection wearing a protective, the high-vis vest and not have to have a cruiser there.
All right. The other question I had was, you put a policeman in the schools. Have you had any incidents with it at all this year?
What do you mean? What kind of incidents? I'm not sure, again, what you're asking.
Oh, you have a policeman assigned to the schools.
Mm-hmm. We have two.
Have there been any incidents?
Yes, we've made arrests, investigations. Scares, all kinds of stuff happens at schools. Yeah. Yes.
Is this high school and junior high?
High school. There's one assigned to the middle school, but he also covers the other town schools.
Okay.
And they work frequently together.
Okay, Mr. LaBranch is moving the question. Have a second to move the question?
Second.
Okay.
Just going to call for a vote?
Okay.
No, right. We've got a motion. We've got a second.
All right. And to move the question, hands?
And a discussion. Wait a minute, discussion before you can vote on it. There has to be a discussion on the motion.
All right, go ahead.
I just wanted to point out to people who are getting very impatient, Mr. LaBranch, that it's important to know
we're getting
why
lost in the
chief of police would be in Durham when he's on regular salary, and he should be here, according to some people. That was the point.
That was discussed.
I think it may have got part of that resolved.
I think it was discussed. Thank you is right.
Okay. In favor of the motion to move the question. Okay. You are not in favor.
Correct.
Jones is not in favor. Okay, now the main motion. The first section, and we will get through it, $502,814. In favor of moving that forward to our final review. Okay, you know.
Madam Chair, I'll move crime control and investigation. $553,265 to final review.
I will second that.
Thank you, Steve.
Okay.
You're welcome.
553265?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And seconded by Mr. LaBranch. You understand the intent of the motion?
Mm-hmm.
And you have your backup discussion. Gasoline is in there. Don't get excited. We're going to resolve all the gasoline with Christy at our December 1st meeting. It's pretty clear cut. Consultants, uniform allowance, etc. In favor of Mr. Jones' motion for crime control and investigations, 553265.
I'm in favor. I just want to make a comment about the gasoline.
Oh, yeah.
Gasoline, about, if I may. This is another example of where the actual and the requested don't seem to match up. You're more than doubling the 9 month usage, and that wouldn't quite work out mathematically. You've got 16,000 so far this year, and you want nearly 35,500 for next year. So we'll not only question the cost of the gasoline, but we also have to question the ratio, the guide that they use to estimate 2017's usage.
Mm-hmm. Well, we'll be checking that when we go over the default budget.
Madam Chair, I'd like to move traffic control.
Wait a minute. We were unanimous.
We were indeed.
The second on crime control.
Branch. LaBranch.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Move traffic control and patrol for $2,085,930.
I'll second that.
And once again, the gasoline we'll do later on. Okay, regular wages, overtime, intoxilizer, etc. Questions on this account? And you have all of the backup information that the chief put together.
The only thing that's up in this one is 4.34%, and that's for regular wages, which I assume is really a derivative of the union contracts. So nothing to say here.
Okay. Everybody comfortable with that?
Yes.
Account and that figure. In favor? Hands?
There you go.
Unanimous.
Madam Chair, I move training for the police, $35,174.
I will second that.
Okay. Thank you, Steve.
You're welcome.
35174.
Sorry, who's the second name?
Steve.
Yeah. Mr. LaBranch.
We're trying to be consistent here.
We're paying him for his services as a second.
Madam Chair, this training is up 16.19%, largely due to
training
and recruitment, which is up 22.2%. And I'm sure the chief has a very brief explanation for that, right, Chief?
I'm hoping, Tim. I'm hoping. I'm in the same place you were. Training recruitment is 8,100. I did add some money for ammunition costs. They are going up. That's part of it. We increased the amount because we are shooting more. And then we added. No. There was some weapons upgrades and repairs, some of the OC gas, and we actually bought, based on what was going on earlier in the year, we started doing some training dealing with civil disorder, or what we used to call it, riots. We were starting to see things amp up. We had a pretty busy preseason. So some of that was placed into that.
I believe, is those addresses you're seeing. And we are now testing. No, pardon me, that's career development. The testing's in another location, so I don't want to use testing as my issue on that.
So when you say shooting more, you mean shooting more target practice?
Yes.
Training.
That way we don't shoot when we're not supposed to.
I understand. I just wanted to be clear, because some people thought maybe we're shooting more generally.
No. We've been
just target practice.
We've been pretty good in that area. We've been doing pretty good.
And you said you were buying
area.
Something other than bullets? Were you saying you're buying guns as well?
No, just up. We actually had a great year last year. We wound up getting a gun-for-gun swap on the ones that we were carrying. We were carrying guns that were we got back in the 90s.
So the only thing you're buying out of this is bullets, basically.
Basically bullets and upkeeping equipment. Sometimes pieces will break and you have to upgrade things. Sights will go. Small things like that.
And you put that under, those are all under training. That's odd. It would be under equipment repair in my mind.
Well, you and I have had this discussion.
But now we're going to talk about radio maintenance soon, I'm sure. Yeah.
Anytime, I have no problem sitting down talking to Tim and clarifying things. I agree with you. There's, we could do a better job clarifying.
And I have to say that Christy has improved county visibility notably this year.
Yes.
This is one area that she hasn't gotten around to. It takes a long time to change this boat around, and I appreciate that. I just wanted to highlight that the climate is all training.
The needle moves slowly.
Thank you very much, Chief. I'm happy, Madam Chair, and ready to vote.
Mr.
Steve,
no, question. No,
I'm sorry, I think we have a question over here.
Just a quick one, believe me. Under the ammunition, when I looked earlier, I thought I saw something like, I think in a buckshot.
Yeah, we still have slugs in our inventory, but we also use...
It's going to say how we do...
It's still in our inventory. It's still an option for us.
Really?
We haven't used buckshot in years. We've been using slugs. If you carry shotguns, you use slugs. You don't use buckshots anymore. Very rarely. And there's some crowd control applications also.
Oh, if you should.
Okay. Steve, go ahead.
I'm not using buckshot, no.
I just want to make a point that talking about training and recruitment. The budget for 2016 was $22,074, and actual so far this year is $51,721. And of course, the Board of Selectmen's suggested number is $26,974. And you mentioned something about additional training regarding training for riots. I'm just going to.
Obviously, we've had a very contentious year politically.
And I think that everybody should remember the motorcycle officer that was surrounded by 500 college-age students that was handled extremely well because of good training. Mm-hmm. And so you're adding to that training, and that's perfectly acceptable.
We entered into a cooperative venture with the New Hampshire State Police to start getting the crowd control training back to the point we had so many people interested. We had people coming down from as far away as Dunbarton.
Yeah.
It's a national issue in law enforcement, getting back to those basics of crowd control. And there's a lot more to it than people understand because you're incorporating a lot of things. You're incorporating not only the officer, but using less lethal force. You're trying to move a crowd, but you're trying to do it with minimal injury. And that isn't accomplished easily. I know, Steve, you've seen me down there on the 4th of July dealing with some of the hostility and some of the folks that don't want to cooperate with us.
But the end result is that in the town of Hampton, because of that training, the results that end up happening come out very well. And it's because of your training.
I believe that's true. It's hard sometimes to point to it, tangible thing. But when incidents don't occur, I'm going to declare victory. It was because of training.
I'd have to go in that direction. I mean, and just knock on wood, and I'm going to leave it at that.
Okay.
Period. Thank you very much, Chief.
Brian?
Hiring of officers, are we doing a fall class?
I think that's going to come up in support if you want to talk about that under that call.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have three quick things. I noticed, and we went by it pretty quick, but you're spending the extravagant amount of $100 on prisoner food. So obviously you're not ordering from the finest restaurants.
I can't remember the last time we actually had to dip into that. We keep that there just in case there's an incident, but generally we don't like to keep prisoners around in the PD long.
Get them out quick so you don't have to feed them.
Usually it's about a four-hour limitation because I don't want to keep the officer off the street. And if they're not, a lot of times, obviously, we arrest a lot of people from other places that there's a distance before they can make bail. We try to give them every opportunity to make bail at Hampton, but if not, within usually a four-hour window, we ship them west to the county jail and they can wait there. So there's not really a lot of opportunity where we have to buy food. I just want to keep $100 in there just in case.
I just had to chuckle over that. And I have learned since last year that live fire exercises for the fire department does not mean that the police department is shooting at the firefighters.
We've thought about it on occasion, but no, we like those guys. We're trying to incorporate a lot of joint trainings with them. You'll be seeing some of that coming up next year with some of the things we're doing, trying to put them in a better protective state.
That did present an interesting mental picture, however, when I saw that notation. And anybody left, maybe Ginny, who remembers the sand pits?
Oh, sure.
In Brentwood?
Mm-hmm.
When we started in the late 70s, firearms training. And I talked to a lot of the police officers there and the part-time officers, and some of them had never fired their weapon. And now, of course, we have our nice training ground in Hampton. But a lot of progress in a relatively short time. And I don't know, if they try to discontinue your training area here. There's
well, you may not get too far ahead, but in the future, it's something we're going to have to consider as a town to deal with that, simply because the folks in that neighborhood are increasingly complaining about the noise level, so we've minimized it to the degree we can.
We walked that neighborhood with the fire chief and the police chief and all the selectmen, and we went through a lane and all through there to explain to them the necessity of having that there, and I'm really proud of that, frankly. All righty, I think we've beaten this to death. Mr. Pierce?
Yeah, on the uniform allowance from May, that back up a ways, you have motorcycle unit, four leather jackets, and four riding boots. Is that something you buy every year?
Sorry, I thought we were on training.
It depends. Where are you, Mike?
We're on training, Mike.
$35,174.
Well, I wanted to ask the question. Let me get back up a little bit.
Well, I don't know if you can after you've already
the jackets.
I don't have no problem answering it.
The jackets and the boots depend on whether you have the same officers year to year.
How many people get the riding boots or the jackets?
Right up here.
That's a good job.
Mike, what were you talking line item 4900? Uniform allowance?
Yes, that's it.
Okay, what specific item do you want to talk about?
How many people do you have in the motorcycle unit that would require four each this year and four last year?
Jackets and boots.
Oh, that's minimum, Mike, because you got wear and tear on the boots, okay?
Yeah.
They're a very specific boot you have to wear, and because of the heat we're exposed to on the bike, but also in the environment we work in, I'm replacing boots with some frequency. The jackets, not as much, but I'm getting very low on my riders. I added four riders last year. If I can run a class of 8 to 10, if I can find guys that are interested, I'm going to run it. But I put in four because it's just a matter of how many people can I afford to have go up the Seacoast Harley for the training in any given moment.
So back to the part of the question is also you got four sets of boots at $2,200. They're kind of pricey, aren't they?
Yes, they are.
Oh, yeah.
And so is the jacket.
Yes, okay. They are.
Thank you.
Okay. Are we ready for the vote on training $35,174? In favor?
Madam Chair, I move support services for the police.
743048.
$743,048 to the Budget Committee's final review process.
And I will second that.
Okay. And Mr. LaBranche seconds. Regular wages, part-time special officer wages, summer coverage, overtime, court wages, uniforms, telephone, medical service, radio maintenance, etc. Okay, questions for the Chief?
Ma'am, if I might. Go out of order a little bit here. I can probably offer a little information that might
go for it.
Stop some of the questions because I did a couple of things in this area that I knew would probably gain attention. One of the areas you see is the part-time special officer wages and then the summer coverage full-time officers.
Right.
Historically, it always had that part-time officer wages line. But I believe it was Selectman Nichols a few years back, wanted to see a breakout of how much of that was being covered by full-time officers, which created that second line. Looking at the historicals, what I found is we would always run significantly under on the part-time officer line, and we would always go over on the full-time coverage line. So I just took some money from one and put it in the other. Yep. And I did it based on historicals, and that's how I came up with that. So that's why you see those numbers somewhat different from previous years. The other item that I added was, we talked about the outside detail issue, and I believe we talked about the fire folks being paid out of Fund 26. Mm-hmm. Earlier in the year, we had that incident when Officer Moustakas was surrounded by a hostile crowd. And it caused a lot of things. We were moving forward in a very contentious time with politics, and I still think we're kind of involved in that now. I had to make some decisions. Consulted with the state police. The state police is in the same issue we have. They're having trouble with recruitment and retention. And I don't think it's any surprise. We send guys to training on how to weed the new employees coming in. The folks coming in, the millennials, they don't take as much work as we used to. I mean, you look at folks like Mr. Henderson and myself, we work a lot. They don't work those number of hours anymore. They just don't. We actually have a class on it called Managing the Generational Divide.
Wow.
And that's one of the things. They do not, the quality of work is up there, but the number of hours they want to work is much less than a few generations before. So that is added to part of the problem of trying to get enough officers to work the work that we need to work. So the old standby was, I'll call in more troopers. Mm. And they have the money. They're up against the same problem we all are in law enforcement. We're in a very transitional stage across this country. Mm-hmm. You recall back in the late 80s and early 90s, there was a lot of grant money that brought a lot of officers into the street crime acts and all that, brought a lot of officers in. But you're seeing them coming to the end of their career cycles, and they're being replaced by people that just don't work as many hours. So battling that, I had to make a decision. So one of the things I did was talk to a number of these agencies that we have mutual aid with, primarily the University of New Hampshire and the towns that are part of our Seacoast Emergency Response Team. We have working relationships with them. Mm-hmm. And I made the decision that the work that I felt was necessary, particularly on the weekends, that our officers couldn't fulfill, and I couldn't get the adequate support from the state police or the sheriffs, that I would put those out to these outside agencies. We paid for that out of the Fund 26, similar to what the fire department did. But it, as the manager said, you don't want to dip too far down into that. That was a stopgap way of trying to fund that. I believe it should be in the budget, so I did request a sum of $30,000 be put in the budget to cover that type of expense so we can get experienced officers in there to assist us. My intentions are to begin this program as early as the warm weather hits. If we start getting warm weather in April, my intention is to start augmenting my staff, first through my own people, and then if I can't get enough officers in the house, then I have to resort to bringing in officers from the outside to have proper safety at the beach. So those are the three big areas I thought I might experience some questions on. There may be others, but those are the ones I thought I might experience some interest in.
Okay, questions, Fuji, on this section? Sunny, and then Steve?
At the beach, you're providing the police. Are you billing the state for making the arrest?
What?
There would be no mechanism to do that.
No, you're covering the beach. It's state property.
It's in the town of Hampton. Doesn't matter if it's state, privately owned. It's under the jurisdiction of the Hampton Police Department, and that's our responsibility. So you can't bill. It'd be like going to a restaurant, and they have a problem with a patron. We wind up arresting and sending them a bill for that. That's not something we can legally do. There's no mechanism for that.
Okay, Steve?
If, in fact, state police gets their budget restored and everything, would we go back to the way it was for the last 30 years, bringing them in to fill in for us? I mean, we all know the work that they do. They bring in the cruisers. They know the area. Mm-hmm. So we bring them back, and then that maybe would reduce the summer coverage budget.
It's not their budget. Their budget was fine. They're actually looking for an increase in their budget. The true problem was with the coverage areas that they had, they didn't have. I remember some weekends that we'd have a one or even no troopers come down because they were tied up in other places. Mm-hmm. And again, they're experiencing the same thing we are. The workforce has changed. The people coming in are different. They have a different mindset about what they want to do. So counting on the state police in this time frame right now It's just not something I can count on. I have to have that as my stopgap. I will certainly be speaking with a new colonel. Obviously, I have a very close relationship with the prior colonel, working as he worked down here in Troop A and coordinating our efforts to the best financial benefit of the taxpayer. But it was just one of those things. It was a difficult spring, and I wasn't going to stand by idly and hope I could get more troopers. Sometimes on the nights, they expect they're going to be sending people to us, and they have to withdraw them because something else has happened somewhere else. And I have to have a fallback plan to that. It is bringing in these outside agencies. Certainly, if I can get it, if I can get support from the state that's not coming out of our directly out of our funding, that's what I would opt for. But I couldn't do it, so that's why I went to this.
See, because I'm looking at the taxpayer side of it on that aspect. I mean, first of all, we all know. I mean, you got the State Beach, State Park, all that state property. We should get something in return. And the fact that over the last 30 to 40 years, you know, they've come down, they've handled it out of their own detail account. Doesn't affect us. And I understand, you know, what the hardship and things you went through this summer, and the way it was done quite well. But I just think that state police presence down there stands out by itself. I mean, they know the area.
I agree.
You know, you clean them with arrest and things like that. And I just think it was a great program, and hopefully we can get that restored in the future.
I'm hoping that things progress in this country. I mean, again, this is not a Hampton issue alone. Yeah. Recruitment for law enforcement is in a dramatic spiral down. Yeah. If you read any of the trade journals on law enforcement, they'll tell you that recruitment is just so difficult right now. When you look at the city of Dallas, what they went through, what they didn't report, was 2 months prior to that, 40 officers just decided to resign and retire because they had had enough.
Yeah.
So as they go through these things, that's what we're faced with. Certainly, the relationship with the state police is strong, and if I could get them to, if I get somebody else to pay for it, I would. But in this circumstance, if things come back during my tenure as chief to where we can get that, certainly, I would reduce the expenditure to the taxpayer.
Has the new colonel been appointed to
PSA
yet?
Chris Wagner, outstanding. Okay. He's worked the state police details for many years, and we've had a good relationship. He was one of the heads of the tactical team of the state police, which I'm the head of the CERT team, president of the CERT board, so we've always worked well together, and Chris is an outstanding.
Bob Quinn got kicked upstairs.
He got kicked upstairs.
Mr. LaBranch?
in a recent meeting with the state, Captain Patrick Murphy was
the lifeguard.
Had an incident reports for this past summer, and one of them was, I believe it was 1,700 arrests for alcohol on the beach.
No, they weren't arrests. Be very clear.
Okay.
They don't have arrest powers. They are not law enforcement.
Okay.
Very clear. So, they are public safety, but they are not law enforcement.
Okay, but he mentioned it. And so it kind of stuck in my mind. So, because I thought 1,700, my God, that's.
I'm surprised. I got to be honest, Steve. I'm surprised it was that low of a number. Those are the contacts they made with people that they documented that were in violation of either. And those are primarily park rules, not law.
Yeah.
We don't enforce park laws, park administrative rules right now. Although we've talked about it, what we enforce are town ordinances, which is open containers of alcohol.
Right.
Or state law, which is, generally speaking, minors in the possession of alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to enforce those because we're charged with that in the town of Hampton. Certainly, I can bring in other assets under mutual aid under my authority as chief of police. I can invite the state police and other agencies to assist us. But the lifeguards right now do not have that kind of authority. I don't anticipate they ever will.
Okay. So just to clarify, yep. So 1,700 isn't the number. Because I know that you are involved with your vehicles, and you do have some arrests. But it's what kind of a number would you throw out there? Would it?
Give that to you right now. I just gave my quarterly update to the Board of Selectmen. So for the quarter, which was July to September, we made physical custody arrests. We made 619 arrests in those 3 months, which is a 32% increase from the previous year of 468. Of the 619, were on state property. Now, that's all through the town. That can be anywhere from the the liquor stores to the beach. But I think we all know primarily it's the beach where we're making the arrests with the alcohol offenses.
When you think about it, you're talking about 90 days and 131 arrests. That's more than one a day. So,
and I got to be honest, it could be much higher. We've had to adopt different tactics. The old, when I first came to Hampton PD and I grew up on the beach, anybody had an open can of beer, they got locked up. That was the way it was. Everybody goes, okay? We can't operate that way with the number of officers we have. And we also have, we look at things differently now. You have to look from a risk management perspective. When you bring somebody into custody of the police department, and we're talking about the minor of minor offenses being an open container of beer. And let's, you know, we get a 25-year-old person who just happens to have a can of beer and you bring them into the PD. Well, we bring some other people in that aren't as nice and they want it for more serious things. If that person somehow engages and winds up getting hurt at the hands of somebody that was in there for a serious felony, the town of Hampton is going to pay a lot of dollars.
Yeah.
So the circumstances are now that when an officer encounters alcohol violations on the beach, anybody under 21, we have to take them into custody. We don't have a choice. They have to come into custody. That's the law. When they're over 21, and their conduct is such that we have no other concerns other than the alcohol, they're not being disorderly, they're not impaired, they're not causing a scene, we now give the officers much more discretion on how to handle that. I don't mandate they put them in handcuffs. I want action taken. I want it addressed. I want the alcohol emptied and removed from the beach. We've entered into an agreement with the state park that the Hampton Police Department now has the authority to trespass anybody from the park for any violation of ordinance or their administrative rules. Like, tell them, you got to leave, you can't come back for 24 hours. We've entered into that agreement, and that's been working fine. We tell them, we don't write a summons, we don't arrest them. Pack your stuff, you got to leave. Most times, if we don't arrest them, we write them a hand summons. Must appear summons to the 10th Circuit Court. Instead of bringing them into custody, because the minute you bring them into custody, your insurance companies are telling you, but it's a risk management special, tell you, going through the roof. So if we can avoid it and still provide the public safety aspect and send the message. So after the issue we had with Officer Masakis, the next couple of days we organized teams, we went down, and we announced over PA systems, if you have alcohol, remove it now. If you are found with alcohol, you are subject to arrest. Yes. And we still made a dozen arrests each
day. And I remember the day that you did that.
It started at one end of the beach. We weren't looking to make a lot of arrests. We were just trying to send the message of what people still foolish enough to do it.
And you did.
So we do have to look at things differently now. It's a different time. And we, you know, the people expect a kinder, gentler group of police officers handling things that don't necessarily have to be arrests. And we really try to look at those hard.
Thank you very much.
But the arrest could be much more.
You can add to your message that if we have to arrest you, we won't feed you.
Yeah, we got no money in the budget for that. We got $100.
Buy a lot of bread with that.
Yeah, water and bread.
Everybody comes not up with this water. Motion.
Madam Chair?
on 7, yes.
I actually have a budget question, if you don't mind.
Oh, a budget question.
Tim, I'm sorry.
Okay, go ahead.
Outside agencies, in last year's budget, was zero.
Correct.
Actual spending this year. Zero.
Yeah.
In the budget.
Yeah. In the budget, yes. We spent 26.
I told you this.
But we spent how much money from the police detail fund for this?
I want to say roughly $20,000, I think is the number. It was somewhere in the vicinity of $20,000, I believe.
Mm-hmm. So $20,000, if it was in the budget for $20,000, we'd be looking at a 50% increase, I guess. From $20,000 to $30,000.
The math is much better than mine. I'll take your word for it.
Max, can you confirm that?
Okay, are we all set? Ready?
No, we're not.
Well, move on.
So, I don't understand. I'm not comfortable with them. I'm not sure exactly what verb I should use.
I get the answer for
it. No, Chief, you and I talked on the phone about this.
Not this part, we didn't.
Yeah, we did. Citizen to police chief.
You better not tell them that.
Not budget committee member to police chief, which is what I'm doing now. All right? What I heard you say earlier was that you paid for this exercise of outside agencies. Well, because it's not mutual aid, you have to pay them a detail fund, I guess. But in any case, you paid for it using the detail fund money last year.
Correct.
And you're not going to do it next year because the town manager doesn't think, you know, you want to cut that deep into that fund. Right?
So,
okay. Correct me there.
I just did.
Well, why are you putting into the budget this year versus using the fund?
Because my belief is it belongs in the budget.
Yeah.
That's my belief.
And it should be ongoing, right?
That wasn't the manager's idea. That was my idea.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you owe the manager an apology, and I expect to hear that you did that.
Chief, I hereby apologize for not understanding your characterization. Okay. Trust me, he's watching.
I don't think so.
He's Chief, you what you're...
He's on duty 24-7, just like you, Chief. He gets a car, too, doesn't he?
He was a Sea Org. How could that possibly be true, Tim?
Chief, what you're saying is from now, this needs to be identified as an ongoing expense.
Yeah, and I would expect, as Steve pointed out, if the time comes where we can get back to how we used to operate with the state providing some of this, I could reduce the number, but I want to be comfortable. And the reason it's 30, because we did not talk about this, sir, is the reason it's 30 as opposed to the 20 is I'm going to start this earlier than I started last year. I didn't start doing this until July 4th, June. I'm starting this the minute we get the warm weather, so I'm anticipating April. That's why I put 10,000 more in, just to be safe.
You opened up the door for him.
So that was the calculation to increase 50% was just to be safe.
Yeah.
Pick a number.
Yeah.
All right, thank you.
I felt 10,000 for those 2 months was probably, and my feeling is this, having worked there for the number of years I have, that we are extremely taxed early in the year because our officers aren't ready yet. They're not working the regular schedule. Mm-hmm. So that's why I add that, because I anticipate that if I'm coming out in April, I'm going to be hitting that April and May if the weather's good.
So you're going to be safe at 30,000. Yeah. Is what you're saying. You're going to feel safe. Right? So
I that feel was safe. The phrase we'll
you
used.
You said you feel safe at 30,000.
Tim, okay.
I don't want to mischaracterize it.
Okay. Tim,
would you feel safer at 40,000?
What would you feel safer?
What was the question?
Wait a minute. Well, no. I'm talking about your calculation and how you came to $30,000.
All right.
Do not interrupt me further, please.
No, that's it.
I'm asking how he came to $30,000 and why it couldn't be $40,000.
Give him $100,000 and get it over with.
Fine. If that's what he wants to say, let him say it.
He did say what he wants.
He didn't say it.
Easy.
It's here. And please, Steve has a question.
I can talk now?
I wish you would rather than anybody else.
I don't get that a lot, but thank you. The $20,000 again that we spent began towards the end of June. So we utilized that program for maybe a week, 10 days in June, month of July, about halfway through August, and as normal, it starts to fade off as kids go back to school and all that. My plan is, weather depending, this could kick in as early as April. Now, April and May are very busy months for us, and we're very short-handed because our part-time staff doesn't really start until the middle of June. And their availability, keep in mind, most of these people have other jobs or are students. So I anticipate, granted it's just anticipation and ballparking it, that extra $10,000 is going to cover that period for me. That's what it was. That was.
I'm just wondering, based on when you're talking about expanding the calendar, mm-hmm. which is almost a doubling of the calendar, why the number ought not be 40 instead of 30.
It could be. I was trying to be conservative. I thought you'd like
I'm trying to be accurate.
It's hard to be accurate in my business.
Yeah, it's hard to be accurate in a lot of things, but we have to make our best effort, don't we?
And that's what that reflects.
Okay, Mr. Henderson has a question.
I'll be very brief. Preseason, just to clarify, is the worst time of the year prior to the summer schedule starting. We've had so many points, and I was involved in many of them over the years, where at the point of riots down there, some bad, bad days. So preseason is real bad. So the help is certainly needed. My question, real briefly, is what was the average that we paid for the dollar amount that we paid?
The outside agencies?
The outside agencies.
I don't have an answer to that, but I can probably get it before your end meeting. That's a good question. I should have looked at that because we had a variety of, you know, UNH, Epping, Exeter was coming over quite a bit. Let me see if I can dig that up. That would be interesting information for me, too.
Just to see how that $30,000 fits with what we're paying out for details.
No, that's a good question. Let me get back to you on that.
That's the only question I have right now.
Okay, you ready for the vote? The amount for the support services, 743048. In favor? No, I like that. Special details is zero. Moving on to police station and building, we have a total of...
Madam Chair, I move police station and buildings for $187,029, and not one penny left, right, Jane?
And I will second that.
I'll take more. Chief, you have heating fuel. I'm assuming that's gas?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
I have a question about the electric.
A question? Question about what?
The electric.
The electric? Okay, go ahead.
You know, it's on the line number 4100. You have budgeted 69. The actual is 36, and you're requesting 62. That's twice as much as what the actual is for 9 months. My question is, why is that so high?
Okay.
Why was it so high before, I guess, is even a better question.
Keep in mind, my actual in 15 was 58,000.
Yeah.
Rates haven't gone down. We haven't made any serious adjustments to any of our operating issues within the building that would reduce the usage.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say that 62 is a modest increase compared to the 58. It's actually a reduction from the budget of 16. It's a 10% reduction.
I have no problem with that, except your usage year to date is 36,297, which is...
And that was as of September.
And
we got a whole quarter to go, and I believe you use a little bit more energy.
Do you have electric heat?
Huh?
Do you have electric heat?
No, I don't have electric heat, but I just, obviously it gets darker, so we're putting lights on more, and I think that's going to...
Yeah.
Are you trying to thank me for walking around that building like you do every day, turning off lights?
I don't think...
That's what I do.
I don't think it come across my mind at all, but now that you mentioned it, I will mention it. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Okay, now back to this. I can't see spending as much in the last 3 months as we spent in the first 9 months. That's what we're saying with this budget request.
We can flag that for Christie to help us when we sit down to do the final review.
You want me to make an arrow to that for next to the... we don't have gasoline on this page.
No. No. They don't use...
But keep in mind, we started this process in July.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So when I started putting these numbers together, I hate to say this, the last ones I really worry about are those numbers simply because they're fixed by what the rates are.
Yeah.
So I really don't take a hard look at those until about now.
Yeah.
I appreciate that because I know that as an afterthought, we didn't build the building to be energy efficient at all. It's probably the worst building in town as far as the energy.
Well, we did what was called value engineering, which translated means let's do this as cheap as we can, because we wound up doing things that we would never do again if we built a building.
Nothing we do in town now
okay.
was being utilized in those days. We didn't care. You're right.
Are we all set with our bottom line? Are you ready for the vote?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. 187,029. In favor? Thank you. And Christy, could you just check on that electric for us for the police stations for our review? Okay.
While you're checking that, Christy, I'd like to have a detailed understanding of what took place with the police detail fund in 2016. Income and expenses, please.
We'll do animal control.
Animal control. For the year, when we do the final topic, when we come up to the final on police, it's going to be
round tab on the
detail fund will be topical once again.
Oh, I got it.
Okay. Down by the mosquito.
There we go.
Okay. All right, if you're a chief and Deputy Hobbs, thank you
chief,
very
thank
much.
You.
Did you want to do animal control and emergency?
Yeah,
I'm here. I do the emergency management too.
No, I thought I was kept under control pretty well.
I think we did emergency.
We didn't move the final number.
You don't need to, but I hereby move the bottom line for the police of $4,107,300.
I will second that.
Okay.
Thank you, Stephen.
You understand the intent. That
all those in favor, moving, and only the final review.
Why is he?
Because he's frisky this evening.
That's okay.
Okay, in favor? All right, unanimous. Now, animal control, if you don't mind rescuing us.
I would like to move $63,693.
Second.
And once again, we have a gasoline flag on that account. Yeah. You understand that. Peter McKinnon, animal control, regular wages, uniform. He has his new vehicle, thank God.
Animal control is not one of your departments, isn't she?
Yes, it is.
Well,
it is. Falls under the
PDA. Separate department.
And rabies, et cetera. You understand the intent.
For animal control?
Animal control is 63,000.
It's a tan flag, $63,693. And I think the increase is the gasoline, which we will sort out. Okay, let's see. Did I have the motion on it?
I made the motion.
And Tim seconded. In favor of moving the animal control line forward. Unanimous. We thank you, gentlemen. Thank you. We appreciate your assistance and the detailed budget.
Madam Chairman, before they leave, can I ask one question? Do you know how many weapons are in the town of Hampton?
What are you talking about? Our weapons or the town's people? That would be illegal for me, even if I knew that, to reveal that. I can't even tell you who has pistol permits. That would be a violation of state law and people's privacy.
You think some of the residents are armed better than you? Or?
I wouldn't comment on that.
Depends on how you plan.
I have to tell you what I have in my own safe, and I'm not doing that.
Gentlemen, flee while you can.
Thank you.
Meet again on the 29th of November. That's our next Channel 22 date. Yes. And that will be strictly public works, including Rolling Stock.
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
The IT committee sent a response to the answers that the budget committee got to its questions from what turned out to be Jamie Sullivan, I believe.
Right.
And I wanted to state publicly, as I did in my email, that the IT committee met, embraces the fine management leadership that is reflected in having an IT report, and is suggesting that the budget committee not address the MIS budget until that IT audit report can be evaluated. And I want to give you guys an opportunity to ask any questions you might have, which I'm sure you don't. So that's all I have to say.
On that, I'll move to adjourn.
Second. You're moving to adjourn at
9:27.
Yes. All right. Can I have seconded one? By?
I tried. Seconded by?
Ginny?
I'll take one. I gave one to Jesse.
Ginny.
Yes. In favor?
There we are. Thank you. Channel 22. Thank you.